When you think Virginia, you think Ralph Sampson. 7'4", the original Tower of Power. How about Sidney Lowe? Great player, now a great coach. He's come home again. And Jimmy V. Buck, looking for somebody to hug.
Doug, I'm excited. Basketball country. We're in the heart of it, folks. We're going to see it today.
Tobacco Road, what a great matchup. UVA, NC State.
Hey, Gavin.
How you doing, man?
Good to see you. Play, Buck.
Balling, man.
We're just here for the great matchup. UVA, NC State.
Oh, no, this is a basketball scrimmage. This is our red and white game.
Doug, I told you we took the wrong turn coming in here.
Oh.
Well, don't worry about it. The Carter-Finley is actually right outside. You can't miss it. Big stadium.
Gotcha. Thanks, Gav. Thanks for straightening us out.
Man, thanks, bro. Appreciate it. I told him that.
We came to the wrong place, Buck.
Can you still shoot it?
I can still check. I can shoot the three.
Inside presence, big rebound.
Let's do it after the game. Lights will still be on.
Okay.
Better call some football.
Go.
Come on. Live from Raleigh, North Carolina, major excitement on the campus of NC State. It's not only homecoming, but today in a major ACC matchup presented by Allstate, the Pack, hosting one of the hottest teams in the country, the Virginia Cavaliers, looking for their eighth victory in a row. Hi, everybody. I'm Doug Bell alongside Charles Arbuckle. And Buck, basketball was great today, but I'm excited about this game. Virginia, one of the most exciting teams in the country.
Well, Doug, we go from the hardwood to the gridiron. Yeah. I'm happy to be here as well.
Hey, let's talk about the man who emerged last week for Virginia. Who was number five? Mikel Simpson made a name for himself in a big way.
He really did, Doug. What he showed was some outstanding ability to run the ball, do things down the field, have ESP, explosion, speed, and power, and great vision. I think the thing that surprised everybody, he made all those catches. But remember, he was a receiver, moved to running back, moved to receiver, moved back to running back. I think he's standing at running back after having 100 yards receiving and rushing last week.
He is a versatile guy. Defensively, Chris Long is the man for Virginia.
Well, you know, when everybody on that Virginia team comes and looks, Chris Long comes out, pats the ground as hard as he can. All those guys get around him. What he has is the ability to rally those guys around. The thing with Chris Long is his ability also to play with a high motor, high intensity, and just really get after you. I mean, that's the problem with him. You got to have some good things to stop him. If you don't, he'll beat you up all game.
How about this Wolfpack team? Daniel Evans has settled in at quarterback last week against East Carolina. He came through in a big way.
He really did, Doug. And I think the thing is, he managed the game very well. Had a good first half against Florida State. Came back the next week against East Carolina. 335 yards passing, 3 touchdowns. And he was very good with that offense.
And at running back, Jamel Eugene, because of injury, has found himself in the starting slot. But he's pretty good.
He's good. You're going to see him out of the backfield. You're going to see him catching the ball down the field. He gives this offense what it needs. They got to run a lot of screen and draws today to slow down this Virginia defense. He's going to be a key focal point today.
It's been raining all week in Raleigh, but the sun is shining for a homecoming. The field a bit soggy, but it should be fun. Another close one expected between Virginia and the Wolfpack next on ESPNU. A terrific atmosphere at Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina. Today, the Wolfpack taking on the 15th-ranked Virginia Cavaliers. Here's what's on tap. The Buck stops here. Buck will break things down like nobody else. The last of the unbeatens will go through it for you. And what a season it has been for Virginia, the cardiac Cavaliers. Let's go down to the field, the soggy field, and Melissa Knowles.
You know, guys, I checked the weather report yesterday, and this area received more than 2 inches of rain. So to compensate for that, the guys today are changing their cleats. Instead of using these normal cleats, which are rubber at the bottom, they'll be using these metal ones. Now, these are actually screwed in, so this gives better tracking on the field. I walked around, touched the grass. It's very slippery, especially here on this right side. Guys?
Melissa, that will be a factor today, and we'll be checking in with you all day about the soggy conditions. They couldn't cut the grass. They couldn't even fill in the letters on the field because it was so wet. And Buck, just the linebackers dug it out for a warm-up.
That end of the field was really dug up by where they were warming up.
So the Cavaliers will take the first kickoff and bring it out to the 20-yard line.
Big Nate Irving, 56. Nate Irving had a great game last week playing in place of Rump. And you can see right there, he's going to carry over.
21-yard return. Jameel Sewell has had a fine season, the second-year man from Hermitage High School in Virginia, out of Richmond. Buck, I know you like this guy.
I do. I like the way he handles the game, and he's working to get better and better. He has to just keep those streaky things that he does. He gets hot, and then he gets cold. How can he continue to stay hot? We'll see today.
Uh-oh. Bad snap right off the bat. He has to hop on it at the four-yard line.
Well, the ball is going to be very wet when they put it on the ground. You couldn't do anything to it. And as we walked around, you're going to see if you're the center, once you get that ball, Jameel Sewell has to look at it all the way in. But that was a high, hard snap. Couldn't quite get the handle on it.
So it's a loss of 10 yards, actually 16 yards. And I think he took his eye off it, yep. Buck, because it really wasn't that bad of a snap. But nevertheless, the Cavs in a hole on second down. Michael Simpson bursts free. For the Cavaliers up front, a solid offensive line that has been one of the strengths of this offense. Monroe, Albert, Lipsy, Cunningham, and Barker. Eugene Monroe, one of the top recruits a few years ago, finally living up to all that press that he got. The receivers, you see Joe, Keith Payne starting in the backfield. Phillips will be a tight end in place of Tom Santee, who is injured.
You know, Doug, it's going to be a good matchup between Eugene Monroe, 75, and Martrell Brown, who's got his starting job back for the Wolfpack, number 41. Let's look at that matchup most of the day.
Third down and 13. This offense, 40% on third down conversions this season. Uh-oh. Sewell dodged the one. Blitzer throws it up dangerously, and it almost, yes, it's intercepted. NC State. Dewan Morgan comes up with a pick. Young man from Riviera Beach, Florida, he's a little pumped up, Buck.
Well, Doug, what they're going to do is bring pressure, and that's what you have to do against Sewell. You got to get to him. You got to make him uncomfortable. Thomas Barnes moves him around in the pocket, and then there was good pressure and a good play in the secondary. Jeremy Gray and Dewan Morgan covering. See, Sewell can get out of it, but when he does, he throws the ball into double coverage. And this is what North Carolina State has not been able to do. They haven't been able to make turnovers. They're minus 17 coming in. Now they're minus 16 after that interception by Sewell.
Great field position for the Wolfpack. On the Virginia 38, Daniel Evans three steps and firing to the outside and a misfire. Wide open was Darrell Blackman. Evans just missed him.
They have to do a better job of getting Blackman the ball, and that starts with Daniel Evans. But look at him, 64.3% completion percentage. And the other thing is, last week against East Carolina, Doug, he was great in that first half. They need him to emulate that again the whole game this time.
335 yards, the most since Phillip Rivers in the 0-3 Tangerine Bowl. Jamel Eugene goes left side and goes nowhere. A host of Cavs were there. John Copper in on the tackle as you look at NC State up front. Vermiglio is the true freshman at left tackle. And oh yeah, he'll be matched up most of the day against Chris Long. We'll watch that matchup. Latham has had a nice season in the middle for NC State. Jamel Eugene, we talked about him at tailback. Darrell Blackman, big time talent on the outside. And Bowens has shown ability to make a big play, but not as often as the coaches would like this season.
And he's playing in place of John Dunlap, who has out with an ankle injury. So let's see if Bowens can step up.
Third down and 13. Evans, wide open, caught, touchdown, Donald Bowens.
Doug, you have an NC State ball club that hasn't been able to score early. They did show over the last few weeks, especially in Florida State, coming out the box quick. And Daniel Evans, when he has time like he has there, that's a good throw, but it's all set up by that offensive line who gives him time, because Virginia comes after you on third down. He was able to sit back there and make the nice, easy throw to Bowens, who we talked about playing in the place of John Dunlap.
Well, that was a big play. The coaches are smiling at a 40-yard touchdown strike. Hoshgaard for the extra point. And it's good. Eight times this season, the Pack has opened up on their first drive with a score, but none bigger than this against the 15th-ranked Cavaliers. A sun-drenched afternoon in Raleigh, North Carolina, and the home faithful very excited about this start by the Wolfpack, 7-0 on top of Virginia. They've gotten off to some good starts this season, Buck. Not a surprise they did the same thing against Florida State.
That's the thing they need to do right there. Come out quickly. They haven't been doing that all game, all season long, but when you do it against a team like Virginia, it gives you a chance.
Andrew Pearman out of his own end zone. Gets up to the 20-yard line, takes a good lick, and then falls forward to the 22. Again, NC State is coming out solid. Ray Michael came up with a tackle on special teams.
You know, Doug, I think the real key is Virginia is a team that usually starts pretty quickly or starts slow, and then Sewell will come on in the end. He's been very good at the end of the game. And you can see there, 58.7 on the season. But you can't have those kind of mistakes, interceptions on your first drive, to give this team a short field.
Sewell with a handoff to Simpson. He gets tripped up. On the right side, Allen Michael Cash got him around the ankles. Ritzy stayed up front. You see Young, Presley, Cash, and Brown. And these guys are pretty good, despite being nicked up along the way. James Martin battled injuries throughout his career, but is playing solid football right now. And in the secondary, Mike Archer, the defensive coordinator, is shaking things up. Gray Morgan, Walker, and DeAndre Morgan, yes, they're brothers, in the secondary for NC State. Second down and 8. Simpson again has a big hole. Burst through. He's tackled by Martrell Brown and Allen Michael Cash. Boy, he's quick.
Well, and he is, Doug. And I think the one thing you have to have on that front line is guys that move to the football. They have a lot of guys that get after you.
Hey, a flag down around the 22. It's procedure
offense
against the Cavaliers.
Only 6 men on the line of scrimmage. 5-yard penalty, face down.
Officials talking to Dontrell Inman, who was not on, you know, not in the position he should have been. Playing the flanker, he has to get on the line of scrimmage.
Well, the one thing about this Virginia football team, Jameel Sewell, you saw his numbers earlier, and they're not super numbers. I mean, he's not having a sensational season number-wise, but he's so calm and cool, and he's led them to come from behind wins. This is a confident football team.
He just gets better at the end of the game, and I think his ball club, they get better, but his offensive line, they beat you up so much at the beginning of the game, they're in position to win.
Big bunch, all over 300 pounds. Setting up the screen to Simpson. Boy, that was a big play last week against Maryland. Dewan Morgan ran him out of bounds, but it's a first down, Cavaliers.
Well, Mike Archer, the defensive coordinator, is going to bring heat. And when he does, you see Ernest Jones coming free. He's the free man, so Jameel Sewell has to beat him. He does. He can see that because he's the left-handed quarterback. Makes it easy for him to just see the blitz coming at him, take his time, and then go right to Mikel Simpson.
Al Groh, we talked to the coach this week. He said he got a text message from Bill Belichick. They were very close, and Coach Belichick caught the end of last week's game against Maryland. He knows all about this Cavalier run, and obviously Coach Groh knows the success that Coach B is having with the Patriots. Simpson again, the workhorse, goes nowhere, this time over the left side. Gets swallowed up by Brown and Cash again.
See, Doug, they're playing a little cat and mouse game. Mike Archer knows that he has to put Martrell Brown on the strong side, meaning he has to have those line, he has to be matched up against Stu Parr and Phillips. Well, they start off on one side, then move to the other, and they're trying to run against Littleton Wright and Willie Young. It's just set up perfectly so they can go against the smaller end. They call Martrell Brown more their stud end because he's a bigger guy.
Second down and 11. Sewell out to his tight end. That's Jonathan Stuper. And he gets close to the first down, out of bounds, about a yard shy of the first down.
And there's Tom O'Brien. You know, Doug, he spent 15 years. You think of Boston College where he was, but he was before that, he was an assistant coach under George Welsh. He and Al Groh go a long way back as well.
Yeah, Mike Groh, in fact, the offensive coordinator for UVA, was the quarterback when O'Brien was the offensive coordinator for the Cavaliers.
He's trying to lobby to say the guy went out sooner.
And you can see the footprints. It's like a tennis match where they leave the mark. Simpson gets the first down. Boy, Simpson had a big game last week, but as we watch the tape, Buck, the offensive line, they are really good. For big men, they get out and move.
They really do. Jordan Lipsey is one, the center.
Outside, you have the guards, Brandon Albert, 71, or Ian Yates Cunningham. Those three guys inside, they do a lot with them. They move around to make sure they open some space. So, you know, they don't have a true fullback. They have two tight ends and an H-back, but those linemen replace them and do a very good job in moving.
First and 10 for the Cavaliers. Jamel Sewell, straight back. And another first down, this time to John Phillips, his other tight end. Morgan on the stop for the Wolfpack, wide open.
Well, and normally they throw to the tight end a lot, but what ends up happening with Covington out and Crabtree, now the tight end's become a focal point. This is a good play. Safe, easy throw over the middle. Tight end gets in a dig route, deep in about 15 yards. Nice throw, nice catch.
Back to the ground, Simpson over the left side. Look at that hole. Squirts through for a gain of 7. Let's check in now with a buck stops here.
Well, it has to start with some ability from a guy that nobody knew except his own Virginia teammates. And watch this. This is why it's able to happen. Look at that hole to run through. But when he sees it, what does he do? He gets up there. Michael Simpson at speed, explosion, power. He brings it all to the table, and that's why they like him. He was tentative when he first played, but he was moving back and forth. Now that they've set him back at the running back position, he's settled in, and he's doing a very good job.
He was really lost on the depth chart until last week. Simpson this time gets the first down and more down around the 17-yard line. Martell Brown tripped him up and a bit disappointed to be standing on his feet.
Yeah.
The touchdown.
Well, Jordan Lipsey was out front. Watch pick 63. You see him coming? And if he keeps stays up now, Martell Brown does a good job, just enough to stop him. And that's the area of the field we talked about, too, where the linebackers were working out and everybody was running. He trips up just a little bit down there.
Mike Archer, the defensive coordinator for NC State, told us on Sunday morning when he came in and popped in the tape, said, who the heck is number 5? He wasn't even on the flip card, so he had to pull out the media guide. And he found out this kid has big-time credentials. That falls incomplete. Pressure by Nate Irving.
Well, that's good. They finally come to his backside. So many teams are right-handed with the quarterback, but Jamel Sewell is a lefty. So watch here. This is his backside. They're going to come with the blitz with Nate Irving. And you see there's no one to account for him. Will Barker can't get out there, and he comes off of that backside because everything was slid down. Will Barker is the key because he protects the backside of Jamel Sewell, but right there, that was a good blitz by Archer going to the other side.
Yeah, Nate Irving, only a freshman, and he's been great on special teams, getting more time now on the defensive side. 10th play of the drive. Tight end again, Jonathan Stupar goes way up for the catch.
You know what happened right there? That was a good play by a veteran tight end working on the linebacker. Stupar was working on Nate Irving and did a little out route. Nate Irving, a redshirt freshman, good sometimes in coverage, but that's where you get beat. Those
time
tight ends try to work you down the field.
They're going to measure to see if he got enough for the first down. It's been a balanced drive, Buck. 5 runs, 5 pass plays. That's what you like to see. Keep the defense guessing.
Well, you know, Mike Archer wants to bring some pressure. He wants to make Jamel Sewell move around and then make sure you're there to stop him once he gets going.
You can see how wet that turf is already. A bit chewed up early in this first quarter and just shy of the first down. Look at Al Groh wearing that sweatshirt. That's his staple. I mean, and we met with the coach. Remember the air conditioning was cold, and he had to put, he goes, excuse me, let me get this sweatshirt. And I said, coach, I wouldn't have had any other way.
Well, you know, his buddy and partner in crime, Bill Belichick's sweatshirt wearing guy too. So, you know, he has really been around that system with Bill Parcells and Bill Belichick, and he is going to stay consistent with this program. That's why they're winning ball games this year.
Belichick has a hood. It looks like it needs to be washed. Coach Groves looks pretty sharp. Third down and about a foot. Sewell keeps it himself, and it's a first down, Cavaliers.
Flag
down right at the line of scrimmage.
You know, it's definitely going to go against the defense this time. That's what happens on those short yardage plays. I think they were lined up in the neutral zone. It looked like the defensive line offsides before the play even started. That's what happens. You see those guys want to get up there and try to jump the gun.
Offsides, defense in the neutral zone at the snap, half the distance to the goal.
distance results in a first down.
Yeah, they're over the line right there, and that judge, the official on that side threw the flag there. Trying to get a beat on the quarterback. You got to get low. But what's neat about that picture that you just saw is look how low the defense is and the offense trying to get low. Whoever can get low, the lowest, to get the leverage.
First and goal from the 4-yard line. Sensen Bloy runs right into a stone wall named Martrell Brown. I can hear from up here.
And Martrell Brown is playing at a whole nother level now. You know, they talked about it earlier, how he was barking and what his bite wasn't much. Didn't have much bite. But this play right here, you beat guys individually, and let's hear the sound of it after he gets over to the other side of the line of scrimmage. That's what's the key there. I mean, he's really playing some football now.
Brown is a guy, he's a team captain. It's interesting, Mike Archer actually took him out of the starting lineup in the Louisville game that we called here a few weeks back, and he earned his way back in, and it didn't bother him, it motivated him. To the outside, it goes to Stupar, his third catch of this drive. Dewan Morgan swallowed him up. Short game.
And the real thing with Martrell Brown is that they named him the co-captain. So that was what they wanted, to see him play like a captain. And I think he is now, Doug.
And now he's getting the crowd into it. Look at 41 out there. Trying to get the crowd involved. Third down and goal. Sewell to the outside. Incomplete pass.
You know, Doug, for everything that's talked about with Chuck Amato, the one thing that he did leave was some great defensive players. They had guys drafted very high on that defensive front. The ball just thrown a little bit too far away. But this, the holdovers from that staff and those guys that are still here, Martrell Brown is one. They got to see Mario Williams play. They got to see some high-level guys, and they're learning from that. And you can see how well they're playing behind that.
23-yard, 3-yard field goal attempt for Chris Gold, the senior. Puts it through. So the Cavaliers, calm, cool, and collected, drive down the field to cut into the lead. It's 7-3 in Raleigh. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate. Are you in good hands? It is the weekend before Halloween, and our crew feeling it. Nice pumpkin shot there, huh?
Ghosts and goblins action.
Those folks just excited to be outside because it has been a gloomy week here in Raleigh. In fact, when we flew in earlier this week, it was a bouncy flight. I like those smooth landings, you know. Blackman bumps it up to the 31. Check that. That's Bowens on the return. So again, good field position. For NC State, Melissa off the top, talk about how wet the field is and players are kind of changing their cleats and that sort of thing.
Well, not only the cleats, but the length of them can be longer too. The ones that she showed were one size, but you can go even a step further and really get those long cleats. Because usually you like to wear the rubber soles, but a lot of guys wear the screw ins. The offensive linemen, they may not change. That doesn't really matter for them.
The big guys are going to be deep into the turf regardless. First and 10. Daniel Evans' first opportunity was a touchdown drive. 40-yard touchdown pass. A little dangerous pass that was almost intercepted. Let's check in with Mike Gleason in the studio.
Well, Doug, Oregon had the lead on USC until Mark Sanchez strikes
again.
He
goes to his big target, Patrick Turner, fights off the press coverage. Runs a corner route, uses a 6'5 frame, pulls in a touchdown.
Nice job, 10-10 USC Oregon at Oxon Stadium, Doug.
All right, Glee, thanks. The Ducks 5-1 all tie versus the Trojans when higher ranked. Oregon currently ranked 5th and USC 12th. USC healthy, though, finally. So that'll be one of those games to watch as the Trojans try to make a late season push. Evans was hassled a bit, and that is incomplete. Did not catch the ball. Good hit by Byron Glaspie.
Well, you know, Doug, whenever they come with something, they're going to have people behind it. So you can see Copper coming first with the blitz, and then Glaspie in position right here. Boom, to make the hit. Receiver doesn't have a chance to come down with it. Said Hickman doesn't have the ball, doesn't have it long enough. But it was a good play by Glatzby of being in position after that blitz.
Third and 10. Evans from the gun. Here comes Chris Long. Had to just throw it away. And it bounced to John Copper. Let's check in with Mike Gleason in the studio. Mike?
And we check on your Florida Gators, Doug. Gators in Georgia. No Sean Marino. Already has one touchdown. Look at this. Bouncing, looking for some running room. And he finds it. And he finds the end zone. 2017 Georgia by 3, Doug.
Wow. No defense in that game, Buck.
Instant O. Both of those ball clubs. Georgia plays well on the road. Florida trying to get back in the higher BCS contention.
Yeah, a couple of those teams in the SEC East, Florida, yep. South Carolina, control their own destiny. If they yep. win out, they're going to be in the SEC championship game. Bradley Pearson changed his jersey today, usually 26. Today, number 20. Left-footed kicker. He's had a terrific season. Fielded right at the 30-yard line. Vic Hall brings it up to the 32. Jimmy Sutton on the stop for the Wolfpack. Uh-oh. Scary happenings here in Raleigh. Look out. Looking at the great southpaws. College quarterbacks throwing from the left side. Steve Young, BYU. I love that face mask of Steve Young. And this was Snake Stable with the Mud Bowl at Legion Field when he scored the winning touchdown against Auburn. That was back in the 60s. Of course, Michael Vick was sensational at Virginia Tech. And how about Heisman Trophy winner Matt Leinart? I think a Boomer Esiason. So Mark Brunell wasn't bad, Buck.
You got to think about it, but Steve Young kind of tops that list. The only lefty that's in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. You know, you got so many good left-handed quarterbacks, both in college and pro. Not so many, but just so few. But the ones that have played outstanding.
Sewell off to a fine start in his young career. Only a sophomore. Keith Payne at tailback. Sewell looks for his tight end. Almost John Phillips. And a great grab, couldn't hang on. Check back into the studio with Mike Gleason. Gleason.
Well, Doug, last week Clemson got that running game going again, rushing for 341 against Central Michigan. Here James Davis breaks to the outside. It's just a one-yard touchdown. His seventh, Clemson on top of Maryland, 17-3, Doug.
All right, a huge game for Clemson and Maryland. Of course, Maryland had some heartbreaking losses. I think a Wake Forest, the game we called in overtime last week against this Virginia team. Payne, the Payne train. Feels the pain. Javon Walker comes up, nails him right in the side.
Well, Doug, the thing with Keith Payne is Al Groh has wanted him to run harder. That's the one thing. He wants him to run more effectively downhill.
Look at Al Groh's got that sweatshirt pushed up above the elbows. Coach is an interesting man to talk to. Very articulate. Very thought-provoking. When you ask him a question he doesn't expect, he hesitates. But he is a football coach through and through. Here comes the big man, Keith Payne.
Now that's the kind of running you need out of Keith Payne. But Ian Yates Cunningham with a crushing block to allow that to be a first down. Watch Big 77 pull around and just obliterate.
Wow, that's a great block.
Javon Walker.
A great block.
And, you know, it's hard for a big man to go on a little man that quickly, but he cuts him at the right place, and that allows Keith Payne that first down.
Ian Yates Cunningham, only about 300 pounds, and getting out there moving. Boy, that's some good feet.
And a big man.
First and 10 now. Payne is the big package, Simpson the smaller package. More football tonight on ESPNU. It's ACC action continued. Duke against Bobby Bowden's Florida State Seminoles. Saturday primetime college football presented by Citi on ESPNU, 8 o'clock Eastern time. Tomorrow on the U, women's college soccer, top 25 matchup, number 11 Santa Clara, number 6 Portland on ESPNU Sunday at 5 Eastern. And the Women's College Cup will be on ESPNU. Your source for all things in college sports. Sewell goes down. Bedix with the pressure. Also, DeJuan Morgan was back there.
Hey, Doug, this is a whole different North Carolina State defense. We saw them against Louisville, and they played okay. But today, they are bringing pressure. And watching them on film, that pressure is just starting to come from different guys. It's not the same person. That time's Bedix. What Mike Archer did is he said, when we took time, they started coming and bringing different people. And they're all stepping up, playing well. James Martin was there as well.
His brother Patrick also on the team. Three sets of brothers in this NC State squad. Flag down.
Offense.
Legal substitution.
Breaking the huddle with 12 players. It's a 5-yard penalty. It remains third down.
Cavaliers 2 out of 4 on third downs today. This sets them back a bit.
And this is where they don't want to be either. They don't want to be third and long with the way this defense for North Carolina State played. I said it the last drive. Think about it. Mario Williams in 06 was the first player picked on that defensive line. Tank Tyler last year in 07, the third round pick. John McCargo in 06, a first round pick. And Manny Larson, a first round. So they've had good defensive guys. This is where they have hung their hat in the past. Now they're working on the offense. But this defense is coming off the football.
Third down and 15. Percentage is not in their favor. To the ground and Simpson. It gets collared and thrown down after a gain of 5.
Well, Doug, you have now. It's hard to come up with a third and 15 play. Allen Michael Cash just flying in there, wrecking havoc. I mean, he got so many different guys coming. He's a Richmond, Virginia native. Not a whole lot of plays you can call at third and 16.
Wygand on to punt for Virginia. He leads the ACC. Just over 46 yards, a kick. And he is one of the finalists for the Ray Guy Award, given to the nation's best punter. That's back to the 12-yard line. And Blackman fields it and gets knocked out of bounds. A hip shot around the 25-yard line. Of course, we still have some undefeated teams left in college football. Ohio State tonight will be tested against Penn State. That's the ABC game. Herb Street and Brent Musburger will be calling that. BC, what a finish against Virginia Tech on Thursday. Watch that one. Arizona State against Cal later today. And what about our boys from Kansas playing their first game out of the state of Kansas? They're playing Texas A&M.
Well, Doug, you know, you still talk about guys undefeated. There you go. Hawaii also included in that mix.
Hawaii, 4 games, I think, that are virtual gimmies at home to finish undefeated. Clint Sentum, first time we've called his name on the stop of Jamel Eugene. Eugene, an undersized running back out of Naples, Florida. Another one of those kids, the old coaching staff. I mean, they recruited heavily in the state of Florida, and he's one of those kids.
He is, but he's playing because Andre Brown is gone for the season and Tony Baker. And he was really one of those third down receiving kind of backs that they wanted to have. He was going to get a chance to play, and now he's playing full time.
Evans avoids the rush and has to just throw it out of bounds. Clint Sentum was there again.
You know who his roommate is. Chris Long. So I think, you know, Chris probably told him, hey, 5-1, I'm making some plays, can you make some? And I think they give each other a hard time, you know, in good faith.
Something tells me that Long and Sentum, they don't sit around and listen to James Taylor tunes.
No.
I mean, those guys, wow, their apartment's got to be.
The ball beyond the neutral zone.
Got to be cranking, huh?
Complete pass.
Some heavy metal, don't you think?
Well, a little hip hop and maybe heavy metal.
Now let's see, on third down and 8 to be exact. And close to first down, stretching it, is Donald Bowens, John Copper on the stop.
And we talked about Bowens having to make plays, and he's crossing routes on third down, hurt teams, I don't care who you are. He's gonna come across. He made the first down by stretching out. You see, he comes underneath. They kind of lose him in coverage. Copper makes the tackle, but Bowens fights for that extra yardage.
You know, Buck, we have not called the name of Chris Long yet. They've run everything away from 91.
They've really tried to neutralize him, and even in third downs, when he moves around, he hadn't been a factor.
That's the little man. Jamel Eugene with a big game, takes a shot from Long, who always makes a lot of tackles down the field.
Well, Long makes a tackle after Nate Lyles, who's the big guy that comes up to hit for this Virginia team. Now, inside, good blocking interior for North Carolina State. And you see Big 30 comes up, and then Long and everybody else comes to finish off. Eugene has that shiftiness about him. You know, when he gets in there, you kind of lose him. And then he's able to pop out on the other side.
Second and short. Eugene right up the middle over the right side. Gets the first down.
Well, Doug, and his problem that the reason why he didn't play as much earlier, he had some fumble problems too. Struggled with holding on to the football.
I'm watching that matchup, Buck. Jake Vermiglio, the true freshman, number 70 on the left side, matched up against Long. Got tossed against East Carolina last week. Got a little emotional in that game.
But the thing about Vermiglio that the coaches like, he's got a nastiness about him. And they figure they can taper that down. So you need to have that when you're playing Chris Long.
Another first down for the Pack. Evans airs it out. Looking for Bowens again, who had a step on the defender. He underthrew that pass.
Well, and Bowens just really couldn't get his footing. Razai Dowling was covering. And I think he just thought he was going to get to it. And Bowens said, okay, should I go and jump or should I keep running? It looks like he got no man's land. You can see right there Vermiglio on Long on that backside of your screen. And then down the field. See, he kind of hesitated. And when he did, he wasn't able to go and get that football.
It's second and 10. In over the middle with the first tight end. Coming out with the catch is Marcus Stone. Byron Glaspie on the coverage. The former quarterback shows a good hand.
Well, that time they moved Long over heavy, and he was able to get through and almost get a sack. Watch Long with the great arm movement and technique, beating both defenders. However, Marcus Stone down the field, great catch over the middle. This is an outstanding catch in front of Byron Glaspie.
His 17th grab of the season. Back to the ground. Eugene squirms forward. John Copper made that initial hit for the Cavaliers. There you see Copper getting up from the bottom.
He's always around the football. Just, you know, studies a lot of film, former walk-on, just really good at his technique and what he's supposed to do.
Well, it was a very entertaining first quarter on homecoming at NC State. Some miscues early for UVA. They settled in. It's pretty much what we expected. A close one in Raleigh. The Pack on top. It's the start of the second quarter. College football presented by Allstate here on ESPNU. Doug Bell along with Charles Arbuckle. Melissa Knowles down on the soggy turf. Carter-Finley Stadium. Virginia has dominated as far as time of possession, but NC State is leading in the total yards and, more importantly, on the scoreboard, Buck.
That's all that matters.
Evans with time. Wide open. Donald Bowens. Another first down. Let's go down to the field and Melissa Knowles. Melissa? All right, the field a bit choppy, and it's going to get worse as the day goes on, Buck. Although the sun is out, it should dry a bit, I would think.
Well, it's getting late in the day, and it rained so much for the last two or three days. It's going to be tough.
And they could not mow it. In fact, when we were down in the turf earlier, we were laughing. It was almost like a Notre Dame field. You know, they leave theirs high anyway. Melissa, I think we got a mic working. Melissa?
Thanks, guys. Down here on the near side of the field, it's actually a lot wetter than it is on the other side. The sun was shining on the far side, but over here on the near side, you got big puddles of water. So every time their teams come over here, they're slipping and sliding. The cleats aren't even able to really grip into the grass, guys.
All right, we'll continue to monitor that. You see the ACC logo in the middle. Normally that is completely white. And in the end zone where you have Wolfpack and NC State, normally that's red. But because of the rain, they couldn't paint the logos. So we really just have the outlines of the logos.
That was a good throw by Daniel Evans. He looked off Jamel Eugene on that last play and was able to go down the field to Bowens. and kind of took the defense away with his eyes.
Back to the ground, Eugene. And look at John Copper trying to strip that ball. He's good. Let's go to the studio, Mike Gleason.
And Doug, Nebraska trying to avoid their first four-game skid since 1961. Taking on Texas, Sam Keller, Nate Swift, touchdown, 10-3, Huskers on top. Jonathan Stewart, Oregon, eighth touchdown. He's in, 17-10, Ducks on top of the Trojans.
All right, Glee, keep us posted. Second down and 10 now for the Pack. Evans looks all the way. To Bowens on the outside. Bowens has been very busy, and he's been open.
He really has. He's done a good job of moving around and being able to find the open spot and really do a good job of finding the receiver when he sits down in that zone, Doug.
We have had a fun time here at the NC State campus. Of course, we went to the red-white scrimmage earlier today, which was great fun, and now we're watching this football game. Buck, really is, this is the life, huh?
It is.
Evans again to the outside looking for Bowens.
That's the third time they've tried to go to that same play, Doug.
There's the RBC Center, the home of the Wolfpack, and also the Carolina Hurricane, who played last night there against the Montreal Canadiens and lost 7-3. And you see, it's just a stone's throw from the football stadium, Carter-Finley Stadium. And there's the basketball team that had that tremendous run at the end of the year in the ACC tournament. Went to the NIT, a preseason ranked top 25. I think they were number 24 yesterday. Field goal attempt, Hoshgaard, 29 yards. And he hooked it in there. It's good, the Pack on top. When we come back, a man who needs no introduction as far as NC State goes. Well, when you think back NC State basketball, I obviously think of that great team coached by Jimmy V. And look at that guy, number 35, Sidney Lowe. Check out the shorts. I like those shorts. Of course, that was 24 years ago. Sidney's jersey, number 35, hangs in the rafters of the RBC Center. And, of course, all the NC State faithful were so excited when he decided to return to his alma mater and take over the reins of the basketball program. And Sidney Lowe joins us now. Coach, looks like you can still fit in that uniform. What do you think?
Not quite those shorts. Can't get in those shorts.
How are you? You had a big scrimmage today. Excited about this season?
I am very excited. The guys played extremely well. A couple of the young guys, people got a chance to see how young guys play. And it's good to get the opportunity to finally get out there and play in front of an audience.
All right, Zeidenberg brings it out for UVA out to the 34-yard line. The Pack off to a nice start here today. Are you a football fan, Coach?
I am. I follow these guys. I'm college and pro, NFL. I'm a Redskin fan, I have to say, though. I'm from D.C. But
and they're playing the Patriots. Look out.
You know, strange things happen in sports. I experienced it in 83, and that
there you go.
We'll need that kind of effort to beat New England.
Well, that's what I'm going to ask you. I'm from Houston, so give us what it feels like on the other side. The Houston guy, we were so upset when you guys won that whole thing.
Well, it's just like from this side, you know, 25 years later, we remember it as if it were yesterday. I'm sure those guys feel the same way, but not with the smiles that we have.
Another bad exchange there, center to quarterback. Another problem for UVA. Of course, here it was, speaking of the great game. You remember like it was yesterday, don't you?
Just like it was yesterday, that shot that Derek took. He keeps saying it's a pass, but it was a shot.
And Coach V was looking for somebody to hug. I'm not sure, did he ever find anybody that day?
I think he finally just jumped onto the crowd. You know, he didn't have anyone individually, so he just jumped in.
Well, one of the greatest upsets all time. Tell us about the young man. I know you hate to talk about freshmen, but J.J. Hickson, McDonald's All-American, and I understand the crowd loved him today at the scrimmage.
He showed well today.
Yeah.
He's a very talented player, very focused, and I think his greatest asset is his work ethic. He comes to work every single day.
Coach, what got you into wanting to coach? Was it Coach Valvano, or was it someone else along the way in your playing career?
It was actually my high school coach at the Matha, Morgan Root. He once told me that I was going to be a coach, and I believed him, and I always looked at the game through his eyes. I tried to do that and try to learn as much as I can, and I've been blessed with this opportunity.
Let's look at this third down play. And the crowd really making noise here at Carter-Finley. It's third and 10 for Sewell. Over the middle, wide open. First down, Cavaliers. Dontrell Inman, the completed pass on the outside. Walker on the stop for the Wolfpack. And so that moves the chains, a big gainer. Excited about what Coach O'Brien brings to the table here? New regime in football.
Absolutely. Well, you know, his track record, it speaks for itself. He's a disciplined coach. He's going to get, you know, as they say, his type of guys in there. And you know, he's going to do a great job for us.
It's interesting. Every week we talk to the basketball coach. Last week, Jim Boeheim at Syracuse, and you guys are fans. I mean, you guys come to the games and enjoy this stuff, and it really is great to see. That Simpson going nowhere, and that tenacious Wolfpack defense continues to smother him. What are you looking forward to this season, though? Because last year you ended strong. Obviously, you have some talented kids. What are you really looking forward to this year?
Well, just to see how we respond. You know, last year we were fortunate to have a senior at point guard in Ingen Atzer, and he didn't play the entire year, but when he was in there, we were very solid. I'm anxious to see how our young guys at that position handle it, and I think they're going to do a great job for us, though.
All right, second and 10. We'll let Coach break away here and go watch the game with his team. Sewell on the outside, incomplete to Simpson. Hey, Sidney, before we let you go, that red coat that you wore during basketball season, I think you wear against Carolina and some of the other big games. We were hoping you'd wear it today. That's a sharp coat. That's bright, Sidney.
No, you know, I was just coming to be a fan today and watch the game, and that coat, it is bright.
It is bright.
Bright, yeah. No, we just wanted to come and support our guys here and support Coach and our team.
Well, thanks for joining us. It's great to see you.
Thanks a lot.
Number 35, retired jersey. And leading the Wolfpack into really a new era of basketball that everybody's excited about. 3 out of 6 third down conversions for the Cavaliers. Sewell straight back, lots of time, and another first down. Kerry Koch on the receiving end. Young man from Baton Rouge found his way. And once again, as we say goodbye to the coach, it opens November 15th against William and Mary. Monty Tao's old team, New Orleans, who Monty Tao is a great player here, an assistant coach. His New Orleans old team will come in. And then down in Orlando, some of those games will be on ESPNU, the Old Spice Classic. Good to talk to Sidney Lowe, one of the all-time greats. It's the Payne train. Keith Payne knocked out of bounds. Now they're starting to run downhill a bit, Buck.
Well, but the one thing that they haven't been able to do, Virginia, is they've kept the ball for a long time. They've gone 20-20, and the Wolfpack have seemed to tighten up. They did this against Louisville. They've been doing it the last few weeks in the first half against Florida State, in particular against East Carolina. Let's see what they do as Virginia gets closer to the red zone.
See the Wolfpack defense breathing a little heavier. They've been on the field now. It's been a long time-consuming drive. Oh, what a terrific tackle that was. Nate Irving.
You turn on the film, he just shows up. Every time he's on the field, you have to account for number 56. Teaching North Carolina. I mean, he's going to come on that blitz, and no one accounts for him. Jordan Lipsey can't quite get to him, 63. And when he does, he knifes through, and he's able to get there and cause havoc in the backfield.
Loss of 4 brings up another third down situation.
What I said again, when they get pressured, Mike Archer seems to come with something, and it's usually a nice blitz, and it's timed so well.
Sewell has gone to 6 different receivers so far today. Lots of time. Another first down. Maurice Covington on the outside, young man from Durham. We are live in Raleigh, North Carolina, Carter-Finley Stadium, home of the NC State Wolfpack. Doug Bell along with former UCLA tight end Charles Arbuckle and Melissa Knowles on the wet turf. Virginia wearing their road white, looking for 8 wins in a row. First time they've ever done that in one season. And NC State on homecoming wearing those patented red jerseys. Sewell throws it just as he's hit, and it goes out of bounds. Pressure by James Martin.
Well, and they had a play design where Sewell, if he had time, would have been able to get his receiver, Maurice Covington.
But James Martin, like I said, they're really coming with a lot of pressure here. Martin's going to come right in his face. Right as he's trying to throw it, can't release the ball and get it to the back of the pylon for Maurice Covington, who had a step on Jeremy Gray.
This is the 11th play of the drive. Michael Simpson back in there. In the end zone. Overshoots Dontrell Inman. DeAndre Morgan, you see number 21, a freshman. Another one of those South Florida kids, Riviera Beach, Florida, on the coverage. There's his brother, DeJuan.
Well, and once again, Nate Irvin coming from the backside, and Mikael Simpson couldn't quite slow him down. I mean, he had it just enough, and Sewell doesn't have enough time to get that ball down the field again.
Another third down situation. They're 3 for 3 on this drive on third downs. 5 of 8 for the game. And the blitz. Not a problem, intercepted. Bad pass. Second interception of the game for the Wolfpack defense. Jeremy Gray comes up with his first pick of the season, 22 yards on the return.
Well, Doug, they did a very good job, North Carolina State did, of baiting him to throw that football, Sewell. You're going to see they're going to drop people back, and they come with a little pressure on the other side. It's kind of a zone blitz. Jeremy Gray stays on that backside, and there's no one to account for. He's underneath. They have a guy high, and he's able to just step in front of Sewell's throw. He thought he had the receiver all the way, but couldn't quite get it to him with Jeremy Gray. That's 2 interceptions now for this North Carolina State defense. That's why the defense also made changes as well, to get guys on the field like Gray and Javon Walker, who can make plays.
Jamel Eugene runs the right side. You notice everything they're running away from Chris Long.
You know, that's unusual, because a lot of times when you have a guy that can rush the passer, they run right at him. But Long is good against the run, and he can come after you when you're passing the football.
There you see Long, and again, Jake Vermiglio, a true freshman, and he's got the tattoos, the flames down his arms. I mean, he's a character, this kid, and he got a little fired up against ECU, and they had to eject him from the game, but he's held up well against the All-American. Evans to the outside. That goes incomplete.
Well, and Vermiglio that time just tries to go, and you're going to see here, he's going to try to cut Long, and that just slows him down. On a 3-step drop, you're fine. And then he has backside help. He knows 69 Hepe is coming over. Kalani Hepe is going to come over and help him as well. So they're conscious of where Chris Long is.
The thing, Buck, though, the motor on Long.
It goes.
Look out. You hesitate in the fourth quarter, and he's there.
Now, the key is finding him on third down, because Long, they'll move all across the front line. Now he's on the other side, and they go with 4 down linemen, and they really come after you. This time, they're only in 3. Usually, they come with 4.
2 out of 4 on third down to the pack. Blackman goes down to his shoelaces to get that one, and it is another first down for NC State. Mike Parker ran him out of bounds.
They need to get the ball in Darrell Blackman's hands. They want him to catch the football. 3 down linemen coming after him, so he has a lot of time. And nice catch, but good throw by Evans of taking Blackman away from the defense, where he can turn up the field and make the first down.
Darrell Blackman, you and I have sat down with Darrell, and I like him, because he's a cool guy, you know. Nothing really bothers him. Nothing seems to faze him. 1st and 10. Evans. Boy, he was in half of our line. He got it away. DeMarcus Stone, almost out of desperation. What a play by Daniel Evans.
Well, Evans brings this to you. Now, he could just run out of bounds right there and give Long a sack or a short gain. But this is a good play. Watch the defense. Everybody goes to the right, and then he comes back around, and Long's at the last second. Perfect timing to get the ball away. And Evans extends plays. He's able to make plays when it doesn't look like it's anything there. Look at him. Just throwing it up.
Looks like Brett Favre doing some ad-libbing out there on the outside. 1st and 10 now. Evans with time. And just threw it away. he waited as long as he could in the pocket, and then the bell went off.
Well, and looking at the Florida State game, started well and struggled there in that game. But East Carolina, he came back and played very well. Mind you, he's had starts. Last year he started. Harrison Beck came in and started this year. He took Harrison Beck's place earlier in the year when he was injured. We saw him against Louisville. Came in a little bit late in that game. But the key with Daniel Evans is he's been able to make plays, and guys are stepping up and making some plays for him.
Eugene keeping those legs pumping. Whistle finally blows. Chris Long at the bottom of that pile. Let's find out more about this young man, Jamel Eugene. Hey, the buck stops right here.
Well, here you go, a second chance for Daniel Evans, getting a chance to throw that football. These are the things that he brings to the table. That's a quick start, and it comes really well with John Dunlap, who played a couple of weeks ago against Florida State, and they started off quickly like they did today.
His dad, Johnny, a former Wolfpack All-American who's in the booth next to ours, works on the radio broadcast. In fact, Johnny Evans is a folk hero around here. They love him. Third down, goes to Marcus Stone once again. Stone showing some great hands today. He doesn't have hands of stone, does he?
No, Marcus Stone is just making catches. He looked like he may have hurt himself there, got a little knocked out when he came down. Came down hard. But he turns, and this is just a quick out route. 5 yards, you go down, and you put your body on the defense, and you make the catch. Glaspie can't get around him.
Fourth down.
But Tom O'Brien is upset because they thought they had that first down.
The previous play is under review.
They're going to review the spot.
Yeah, he was hot.
O'Brien thought that he clearly had the first down.
Marcus Stone came away with grass in his helmet. So he goes down the field about 5 yards. Boom, he's outside. You see Byron Glaspie coming over, and he catches the football. It looks like he falls on the about the 41 where the first down marker is. Yeah, the ball comes about right there. Be interesting to see what he's just saying. It came a little bit closer, so he wants to make sure that the spot is there.
His knee was down past the first down marker, but mm-hmm. The ball was clearly behind it. I thought it was a pretty good spot, but we shall see. Coach O'Brien always enjoy talking to him. In fact, when I talk to him, Buck, I don't know about you, I always feel like I have to sit up straighter in my seat. I mean, he's an old Navy guy and a disciplinarian, and I say a lot of yes sir, no sir to Coach O'Brien.
Well, it's funny to listen to him talk about the mentor for both of these guys or who they coached under, and that was, you know, Al Groh talked about George Welch, but Tom O'Brien spent a lot of time talking about him as well.
Mm-hmm. Spent a lot of years at UVA under George Welch, as he did a remarkable job just revamping the entire UVA football program. And it was down when George Welch took it over. Way down.
After review, the play stands as called on the field. Fourth down.
I thought it was a pretty good spot. Again, his knees were past the marker, but the ball was right behind the marker.
The best thing to do if you're a coach, though, is get them to look at it or just bring it to their attention, so it gives you a chance to not call a timeout and set up your next play for fourth down.
Look at Marcus Stone. Boy, is he filled out or what? I remember when he took over, I was doing the game here against Southern Miss, when he took over at quarterback, and he wasn't that big back then. He was about 220 pounds. Now he's about 250.
Well, they said he really got in the weight room and worked out hard and really learned how, is learning still, how to play the position of tight end.
Fourth down, less than a yard. This is very close to the marker. Evans keeps it himself and gets the first down. Let's check in. SportsCenter U studio, Mike Gleason. Glee.
Well, Doug, the Oregon Ducks strike again. Jonathan Stewart gets his second touchdown. This on a third and goal. Pounds his win 24-10 Oregon, and Georgia has scored again on Florida.
You know, Sean Marino doing a great job in the run game. Opens up the play action for his fullback, Brandon Sutherland.
It's always good to see the fullback score. Georgia on top.
All right, look out down at the Gator Bowl. Georgia up now by 11. Evans outside, Eugene on the reception. Vic Hall on the tackle for the Cavaliers, along with Chris Long getting out there. The Gators, of course, have dominated that series. They've won 8 of the last 9. 15 of the last 17.
Who's your daddy?
I tell you, Jim Donnan, who you work with at Sports Center, he beat Coach Spurrier once. Coach Rick beat Coach Zook once.
That border war goes one way.
That's the only two victories they've had in the last 15. Eugene on the outside, and he gets. It depends on the mark, but he's very close to the first down. Sintem and Appleby on the stop for the Cavaliers.
You know, Doug, what Eugene gives you is hitting yardage because you have a guy out there in perfect position to make a play, and then he just does just enough to make him miss and pick up 4 or 5 extra yards and a first down or maybe a short third down.
All right, they'll come out for the measurement.
And what I like about him, his moves are generally going forward. He doesn't waste a lot of time. When he goes, he...
First down, Buck.
You know, it helps your offense. It helps your linemen. Because I don't think he was as effective as a runner inside earlier in the year. But watching Tony Baker and Andre Brown has to have helped him understand, okay, I got to get behind these big guys and move. Out of the backfield, he's been good. Can catch the football very well. And when he's in open space, Dana Bible is putting him out in those flare routes so he can just get out on space and make some plays.
10 back to Eugene. Getting that push on the right side.
You see that little hop? It's just a...
All right, Buck, let's take a close look now at number 29. Hey, the buck stops right here.
Right here with Jamel Eugene, filling up the hole that's going to open up, but also filling in for two running backs that are out. You see right there, he doesn't waste time, and then he still makes a move and makes guys miss. Right here, the hole opens up. He doesn't waste time, and then he picks up that first down. You see a lot of that when you watch him on film. Even though he doesn't come away with 100 yards every game, he picks up those hidden yards.
This time, the fake. He's just throwing it out of bounds. Getting pressure from Clint Sintem on the outside. Sintem is an interesting guy. Last year,
it's an incomplete pass.
It is an incomplete pass. Sintem had that shoulder injury last year that really hampered him, and so far this year, no problem with injuries. And like several of the guys in the defensive side, he's having a big year.
Played with one arm.
Now,
pretty big cut-up guy, but one arm playing a linebacker doesn't help you. This year, he's healthy, and that front seven, which includes Long, and then we haven't talked about Jeffrey Fitzgerald, who's another good player on this front, is also, they're playing at a high level.
The Pack, 3 out of 6 on third down so far today. Evans going to Stone, batted up in the air, almost intercepted. I thought Stone was going to come up with an acrobatic grab. It'll bring up fourth down.
Dangerous situation. But he's trying to hit Stone. If he can get it back, he just has the pressure coming. Can't quite throw it. If he throws it out in front, that's probably a touchdown. But Daniel Evans has pressure coming right in front of him. And Stone almost comes away with a nice grab. All goes over the top of Lyles. Can't quite come down with it.
Hoshka, 8 out of 8 on the year. Field goals. Hasn't missed any extra points. He's been perfect. Now from 42 yards on his wet turf. It curls in there again. 13-3 Wolfpack. What a year for this young man in grad school. Went to Middlebury College where he was a soccer star. They needed a kicker, and he said, why not? And what a year. Look at that, hooking in there. Tiger Woods would have been pro proud. ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate. The Wolfpack on top on homecoming Saturday, 13-3. Over the Cavaliers, a team trying for the first time in their history to win 8 weeks in a row in one season.
Well, you know, they're really putting it together. They're doing a good job of playing football. Even when they get behind, Doug, you know they can come back, and I think that's the key for them. They know how to win in close ball games.
Hoshka with a short kick, fielded at the 7-yard line. Busted to the outside is Andrew Pierman. Out of bounds at the 39. Terrific field position for the Cavaliers when we come back in just a moment. NC State surprising Virginia, up to this point anyway, 13-3. Of course, coming from behind has not been an issue for the Cavs. The Cardiac Cavs, the most exciting team in college football this year when it comes to close victories. First down, 7 runs, 6 passes so far in first down. They've been balanced. Simpson, right side, tripped up by DeJuan Morgan. And let's go to the sidelines. Melissa has a special guest.
That's right. I'm here with Tank Tyler, who is a defensive tackle for the Kansas City Chiefs. What brought you out this week into the game?
Well, I got a bye week, and I knew we were playing one of the top teams, so I wanted to come out and support the team, and they're doing real good today.
They're leading. Are you surprised by that?
No, I'm not surprised. We love being the underdog, and we like to surprise other people.
What's your prediction for the final score?
Final score, us ahead. It doesn't matter what it is.
Thanks so much, Tank.
Yeah, no problem.
Guys.
All right, Melissa, thanks. Tank is a personality. As we saw,
if you saw on Hard Knocks, I mean, Tank Tyler just took the show over. And he had the Tank Tyler dance because he was falling asleep in meetings. But he's really playing well for the Kansas City Chiefs defense. And that's one of the reasons him and Dwayne Bowe, who's at LSU, receivers, all the young guys were getting together. But Tank Tyler just stole the show. But look at him. You can't, I mean, he not only is he big, he is quick. First step, guys, whoo, unbelievable.
And here come the Cavaliers now. Second down and 2 for the first down. Sewell showing that mobility. It's a first down. Dumps it off to Jonathan Stupar. Stupar now moves up to 8th on the all-time list as far as tight ends. Catches are concerned. They call it tight end U.
Yeah, they throw the football. Heath Miller was one of those guys that was included in that, but they really like to get, you know, Al Groh talked about that when we met with them. I want guys that are probably 6'3 to 6'5, 220 pounds, 250. They can play linebacker or tight end for us.
And lots of time, wide open in the slot. Let's go to Mike Gleason in the studio.
All right, let's check that Georgia-Florida game again. Tim Tebow, already with 10 rushing touchdowns on the year, out of the shotgun, make it 11. He's in for the score, 28-24, Georgia on top. And coming up on the SportsCenter U halftime report, we'll check more of that Florida-Georgia game, a somewhat bizarre celebration by the Bulldogs after their first touchdown. UConn with a chance to prove they're for real today. Top 25 action, another upset, Doug, and this on homecoming. We'll talk about it at halftime.
All right, Glee, look forward to it. Yeah, the Bulldogs have rankled their head coach Mark Richt a few times this season with their behavior. Sewell over the left side. I know against Vanderbilt they were stomping on the logo after the game, and he ran out and just got him off that logo, and then that was somewhat, if you saw that highlight, where they all kind of ran into the end zone there.
Yeah, he was upset about it. And I think Jamil Sewell was upset on that play because Allen Michael Cash kind of came in. They wanted to run the option. When you have a disruption in the option, it usually comes from a defensive lineman, and he was able to get in and get penetration and stop them from really having a positive play.
Shuttle pass underneath to Simpson, who scampers in for the touchdown. Boy, that was well executed. Beautiful play.
They ran the same side with the option. The last play didn't have success, came back. And this is a good play call because you have Ernest Jones. Watch coming outside. He sees him. Then you have somebody out front. Big 77, Ian Yates Cunningham. Good block. It allows Michael Simpson to get in for 6.
Simpson just picks up right where he left off a week ago when he made the headlines against Maryland, scored the winning touchdown.
Good play calling by Mike Groh on that drive, especially that last play.
This goal line for the extra point. And the Cavaliers answer in impressive fashion. It's now 13-10. Watch the block, Buck, by 77.
Yeah, well, Ian Yates Cunningham, he's got one man to beat. Jamel Sewell does it. Good cut down block right there on James Martin, the middle linebacker. And that's what you account for. Big man that can move around and make plays. These guys, I told you, interior, center, and 2 guards do a very good job. And blocking downfield also is key.
He moves well. Hey, more action tonight on ESPNU. It's the Duke Blue Devils against Bobby Bowden's Florida State Seminoles. And boy, do the Seminoles need a victory or what? Primetime college football presented by Citi on ESPNU. And tomorrow afternoon right here on the U, 5 Eastern, is number 11 Santa Clara, number 6 Portland. Women's college soccer right here exclusively on ESPNU.
Virginia answered quick, didn't they?
Yes, they did. Just over 2 minutes, 2:18 to be exact. Six plays, 61 yards.
That's how you answer the bell.
I mean, that was...
It was a workmanlike...
Without hesitation, just marched down the field.
Well, and it wasn't like North Carolina State was come. They came with blitzes. They showed different looks. But Virginia just really got in their rhythm on that drive. And Sewell was key. Gorham, that big play to Chris Gorham down the field was nice on that drive as well.
So Gold will kick off. Rob Blackman is deep along with Bowens. Blackman fills it at the three. Takes off on the right side. And gets out of bounds up around the 27-yard line. And Buck, this is what we expected. Virginia never blows anybody out. NC State is playing better football. I think we have a game going deep into the fourth quarter.
I agree with you. What they do is they keep the game close. North Carolina State came out with a lot of emotion. You expect that from a team that's an underdog and really been playing well the last 2 weeks. If you're Virginia, you take that, and then you come back and just play consistent, play your game.
I think NC State has done a good job offensively. Dana Bible has moved it around, keeping Chris Long. He hasn't been a factor so far in this game.
A lot of boots, some draws, some plays where it gets him off kilter and bringing two people every time to make sure he can't just come off and attack you.
Eugene this time over the left side. Long was on the stop there along with John Copper. Copper is the only married Cavalier. In fact, after last week, you know, he's a funny guy. They ask him, what about all these come from behind wins? Does it upset your wife? Does she get nervous? And he said, no, my wife doesn't care, but boy, my grandmother's. They really get nervous.
Yeah, he said it's par for the course with him and his wife. They expected all the guys on the team as well.
There's the rushing numbers so far. Second down. Evans. On the outside, a big target, Donald Bowen.
Chris Long coming inside with a shot. He's really able to get in there. But Bowen's over the top of Razai Dowling, who we saw a few weeks ago against Connecticut play as well. Well, watch Chris Long, 91, get in there. But Evans still able to throw it out to the sideline away from the defender so Bowen's can go up and make the catch. Great pass rush by Long, but he's just there too late.
Bowen's five grabs for 100 yards. Last week, five catches for 93 against East Carolina. That's a new career best. A dump off. And again, NC State now responding. They're coming right back.
Yeah, and Evans had all the time in the world on that play. Gave him time, and he was able to go through his read progression and find Eugene on the check down.
And just when you get comfortable, though, with Chris Long, you think perhaps you have a scheme that's contained him. And look out. I mean, this guy's got a motor, and he will be a factor later in this game. To the outside it goes. Mike Parker on the stop. Another completion.
Darryl Davis.
Evans. Yeah.
And Doug, what they did there, they went quick snap. They didn't allow the defensive front to get set. They went quick. They're going in a hurry up, but they went really quick on the last play.
Evans with lots of time. NC State has their timeout wide open. Touchdown. NC State. He couldn't have been more wide open. Coyle George on the outside. Wow.
Well, Doug, Dana Bible said it. We're going to take some shots down the field. And when we get a chance, if you don't get pressure on Daniel Evans, this is the perfect throw. That corner route where you go inside, break back out. Big Hall's not there. There's no one back. The safety is going late. Jamel Jackson, who has that area. Against cover two, when you run a nice corner route, you will get open.
Hoshka's on for the extra point. That's the first touchdown of the season for that young man. First touchdown reception. And Hoshka, you can't have a better season than he's had. Perfect in field goals. Perfect in extra points. He hasn't missed all year. And NC State not missing much right now. They're up by 10.
They're only averaging on the year 21.7 points. They have 20 at halftime right now.
It was a 2 minute, 18 second drive for UVA. NC State goes a minute 33 to respond.
Yeah, and I had to take that back. It's not quite halftime, so you never know. If they get the ball back, they could go up 23 or 27.
Hey, Buck, you remember your first touchdown?
Yes, I do.
Hey, look at the shot.
Yeah,
that's the first
of
many, baby. Hey, ACC, lots happening.
Of course, three teams in the BCS top 25. Matt Ryan, is he the Heisman favorite? It depends what happens with Tebow today. If he brings the Gators back, Ryan certainly, with those two touchdowns in the final 2 minutes, helped his cause. And Wake Forest again moves to 4-1, a game behind BC.
Well, you talk about good coaches. Jim Grove started out the season slow, and look what he did. And at the beginning of the season, you never would have thought Wake Forest would have been in contention. They have played just like Virginia. Virginia got blown out by Wyoming. Al Groh did a good job of getting the staff, getting his players to believe that, hey, we can win. They knew they won. He said this every time we've talked to him. We don't have guys who are going to blow teams out. We got to play close ball games, keep it close, and finish. Have more points than the other team at the end.
So let's see if the Cavaliers, with a minute 31 on the clock, can get a nice return and get in position for a score before the half. Another short kick, fielded just shy of the 20-yard line. Zeidenberg brings it out to the 36. We talked about those close finishes. The Cardiac Cavaliers, it all started with Carolina back on September 15th, winning by two against Georgia Tech. They blew an early lead but held on. Then Middle Tennessee, that's the one where Sewell really showed his prowess as they came roaring back. We did the UConn game.
Yeah.
And that was a nail biter. And then last week, did he get in? Ralph Regent, I don't think, believes to this day he got in the end zone.
Yeah.
Five wins, 6 points or less. No other team can do that. Alabama has four wins by 6 points or less. But Virginia, what a year. Sewell to the outside again. To his tight end, John Phillips. Tom Santy, who I guess would be considered the top on the tier of the tight ends, we didn't see him on the field today. I don't believe he's dressed, certainly not playing today.
Yeah, they thought he would have a chance. He had a foot injury or ankle injury last week, and, you know, they played three tight ends anyway. So Stu Parr and Phillips are already in the game, and then they like to use Santy down the field, and you can see their offense is still clicking even without him.
Now, Phillips, a big target at 6'6". Show those quick feet. And looking for the sidelines. Get out of bounds. Stop the clock. Out of bounds right at the 47. And that stops the clock with a minute 12. Well, that's what a mobile quarterback can do for
that's
you.
That's what he can do right there, Doug, is he can create something that you don't have. All of a sudden, your linemen are coming up the field, and they have to chase him. Look at Martrell Brown and all these other guys having to go after him. That tires you out. You come on a full goal one way, and then you have to redirect your body. Big guys don't like doing that. They like to catch you when they can see you in their sight and not have to move around and then go down the field another 10, 15 yards.
First and 10 for the Cavs, who are down by 10, and if they don't score here, it'll be their largest halftime deficit of the season. Flag down, back at the line of scrimmage.
That came from the crowd. The crowd made that call. That's going to be on Will Barker. Will Barker's going to get that penalty, I guarantee you.
Let's see, number 61, Will Barker was back there in hand-to-hand combat.
Well, he had Martrell Brown.
Holding offense. Number 61.
Okay, I'm not a betting man, but I knew right there.
First down.
And the crowd called it. You could hear everybody in the stadium yelling. Watch 61 at the bottom of your screen. Martrell Brown beats him inside.
He let up.
Yeah, but it was too late. Oh, that's a bad feeling as a lineman or a tight end when you got a guy that's coming off the corner and you got to stop him and he beats you.
So it's first down. And 20. Sewell. Just doesn't seem to be bothered by these pressurized situations over the middle. Whoa. Did he hang on? Yes,
wow.
He did. Maurice Covington gets nailed by DeJuan Morgan, but he held on to that football. Big game.
Good hit by Morgan, but great catch by Maurice Covington. And this is the guy that they missed. Had a broken hand, thought he was going to be a playmaker for him. 6'4", 218. And this is what Sewell's missed. That play fake takes the defense in just enough. Great catch by Covington.
That was a 26-yard pickup. Sewell now over the middle.
Covington again gets thrown backwards, and Al Groh quickly calls a timeout.
Doug, we saw him a few weeks ago against Connecticut, and they were missing Covington. They wanted Ogletree, who's not going to play, had a torn ACL in the spring, hadn't been able to come back. But Al Groh said, next man up, whoever's next,
charge, timeout.
Be ready to play.
You look at Al Groh, a man who spent a lot of time with Bill Parcells. Coach Belichick and he were on the same staff for those Giants teams, and he does a great impersonation of Bill Parcells. We got a big kick out of that.
Well, I tell you, he coached Lawrence Taylor, and I got to play against him later in his career. And even then, 56 was still a beast. And, you know, you had to have your game face on when you are ready to play Lawrence Taylor.
Hey, coming up at the half on SportsCenter U, Mike Gleason will be along with The Flash, Steve Israel. Highlights from down in Jacksonville. It's the Gators against the Bulldogs. Big East battles and a top 25 upset. Of course, what else is news? We have an upset every week in the top 25.
I don't know if you can call them upsets anymore. It's just,
This one, I think, in the Southeastern Conference. I think that was an upset today.
That was. I agree with you.
Sewell has gone to 8 different receivers so far in this first half.
But I said it earlier, Georgia plays well on the road.
Sewell quickly to the outside, throws it away before he hits the turf. Will there be a flag down? Is it grounding?
Number 88 was in the vicinity of the pass.
Well, Sewell
it's an
saw Jonathan
pass.
Stupar and just got it in his area. Didn't get outside the tackle box, but he threw it in the direction of Stupar.
Rump was putting the heat on it.
Yeah, and Stupar is your up back, fullback, H-back, and right there he gets rid of the football. Not outside the tackle box, but trying to throw it to him.
Look at Sewell, look at that wristband. Daniel Evans doesn't wear his wristband on his wrist, wears it on his belt because he thinks it hampers his throwing motion. Of course, Sewell wears it on his right hand. Crowd making some noise down in that end zone. Again, pressured, finds his man. Another first down, Josh Zeidenberg on the catch for the Cavaliers. Morgan brings him down along with Walker.
Second catch on the year, and that first one was huge. This one is even better to keep a drive alive. And what I like about Sewell, waiting to the very last minute to get rid of the football for Zeidenberg.
First and goal from the 7 into the end zone. Looking for Maurice Covington. Javon Walker was there on the coverage along with DeAndre Morgan.
Doug, that's what they've missed about Covington, his 6'4 height. Down here, you can run a post route, or if you run the fade, he's usually going to out-jump the defender.
Good numbers for Sewell. Those 2 picks are not good, and that's, you'd like to think again about those tosses. One early that led to a quick touchdown for NC State. Into the end zone. Touchdown, Josh Zeidenberg.
Nice catch. Nice catch.
I tell you, Buck, this has been fun today.
Well, and Sewell just does a good job of getting in position to make that throw down the field. Look at him just sitting back, finding his receiver up the field. That was a very good job.
Kerry Koch, actually. Zeidenberg made the block, and Koch with the grab, his first touchdown. The extra point is good, and it's 20-17. You know, I tell you, Buck, the wide receivers, only one touchdown going into this game all year for the wide receiving crew. Now that's 2, thanks to Kerry Koch.
Yeah, Stanton Job was the one with the other. The tight ends have done the job of catching all the touchdowns, but now with Maurice Covington and Kerry Koch, even had some receptions on the year, but now coming up with the big touchdown catch deep inside. And that's the thing about this offense. They say whoever's in place, that'll be ready to make a play. We don't care, like Mykel Simpson.
9 different receivers have caught a pass from Jameel Sewell this afternoon. And that's just the first half.
Fast and furious.
Hey, that guy's dressed up for Halloween. He's dressed up like a Cavalier. Well, the Cavaliers have had a season to remember. If they rally today and win again, and I dare say this is going to go down to the wire, I mean, this is the kind of season that you just, it's for the ages, all the comeback victories they've had.
And especially the way they started. I mean, I think
You thought Virginia was going to be a good team this year, but you didn't think they were going to reel off seven straight wins. And when they got beat by Wyoming, imagine everybody outside of their program thinking, well, Virginia, they're going to be, what, 5-6? I mean, whatever. You know, they were going to struggle this year. And to come back and win the way they have has been very impressive.
Here comes Blackman. Looking for a gap. Gets up to the 29 with 20 seconds. We've had three touchdowns in the last 3 minutes. Could we have another score?
Don't go and get anything yet. Don't leave with the 20 seconds that you see left, because it's been fast and furious. A movie, maybe. Fast and Furious Part 4.
You know, looking at Daniel Evans, it's dawned on me, Ty Detmer. Same release, built like
Steve
Ty
Walsh
Detmer.
A little bit. Yeah. We're talking about that.
All right, they're going to go down to one knee.
Call him what you want, but he's effective.
He is having a solid first half. Tom O'Brien, he will not crack a smile. Not until the end, and only if they win, and it'll be a quick smile. That's not his demeanor. What a half we'd had. NC State on top of UVA 2017. Time now to join Mike Leeson and the Flash, Steve Israel, in the Sports Center U studio. Happy Halloween, guys. Welcome back to Raleigh, where NC State on homecoming leads Virginia, the Cardiac Cavaliers 2017, and who knows, maybe another comeback. Hi, folks. Doug Bell, Charles Arbuckle, Melissa Knowles, my partners, my producer Ty Coolis tells me my partners found these get-ups at halftime on the Saturday before Halloween. Guys, you look good. You look good. Hey, what do you think about the pack so far in this first half? I like the way you're playing it up. You actually sound like the mascot. You're not making any noise. Good stuff. Buck, I thought you were here. Buck, get your headset on. You guys get out of here. Get out of here. Quit fooling around. Buck, I thought you were dressed up like the mascot.
You told me I had more time.
Unbelievable. Trying to embarrass me here on ESPNU. Let's take a look at the first half highlights. Oh, Buck, I'm glad you're back.
Yeah. Well, right here, Jeremy Gray actually knocking that ball down and getting a turnover there, NC State. And then Bowen with a nice catch. He's playing in place of John Dunlap. And Michael Simpson with the touchdown. Coming back, Daniel Evans again to Coyell George for 6. And then Jamil Sewell finding Kerry Koch with a nice play.
Koch's first touchdown of the season. 9 different receivers for Virginia caught passes in the first half. Look at the numbers. Back and forth it went. Rushing numbers not eye-popping for NC State, but nevertheless, the first half numbers brought to you by Oxy. To the outside it goes to Blackman, and Daniel Evans picks up right where he left off in that first half, Buck.
Well, finding Blackman on the outside, they want to get him more touches. And the thing that defenses know, that he's so explosive, you can see they're really able to get to him as soon as he catches the football. They don't want him to get open and get out in space.
Blackman, the senior from Williamsport, PA, an all-around athlete, loves to play hoops, great baseball player, and just a terrific all-purpose guy who I think we'll see on Sundays next year. Evans flushed out of that pocket, finds his receiver, Donald Bowens. Bowens is having the best game of his career at NC State.
Well, Doug, the other thing you have, too, is when you look at how Evans gets out of the pocket and stays alive, it's different than Sewell, but it's still effective. And Bowens is finding open spots. Blackman, I mean, all these guys are getting open and allowing him to throw the football. Marcus Stone as well.
Look at the big guys up front. Have done a nice job blocking for NC State. The offensive line an issue earlier. Dana Bible tells us they've become a more cohesive unit here late in the season.
Gets so overlooked, you're right, because we only call them when they do things that aren't good.
Evans calls the timeout. Evans listed at 190 pounds, and I'm not sure he's that heavy. When you watch him in practice and during the game, his pads make him a lot bigger than he really is. He's really a skinny guy.
But he takes the lick, and he's tough, and this is his hometown, and a guy being able to play here.
All right, let's Let's find out more about the All-American on the other side. Big number 91. It's time for the Buck Stops Here.
Well, when you talk about Chris Long, you don't think about instant offense, but I'm going to give you a reason why. This Virginia team has only scored 5 points on the year. Chris Long has scored two of them. You see that outstanding move, rip technique, and getting inside. He has a safety, and they have a field goal. In the third quarter, they have been atrocious. Chris Long, maybe he has instant offense. Pick six, maybe?
Most sacks. We saw George Selby earlier this year, and, of course, when we called his game, fourth game of the year for South Florida, he had 9 sacks, so he's slowed down while Long has just gradually kept moving up. I dare say he'll be the number one guy at the end of the year.
Chris Long is so good with his hands. He gets the guys off of him, and he's able to get through, rip, swim, and get to the quarterback.
Evans is 10 out of his last 12 in the passing department. Making 11 of 13, and who else? Donald Bowen gets into UVA territory. Big gain. Nate Lyles on the stop. Let's check in with Melissa Knowles. Melissa.
Yes, guys, I had a chance to talk with Coach O'Brien going off the field, and he said, you know, I'm proud of our guys. We're playing good football right now. The only thing we need to do is contain the other team's quarterback, and we can win this thing. Guys.
See what happens. Could be easier said than done. Bowens, they have not been able to contain him. Speaking of Virginia, he now has 7 catches for 126 yards. That last one went for 20. Jamel Eugene now kind of squirms and wiggles his way for a nice game.
Yeah, you think he's not doing anything, but all of a sudden you just see him down the field for an 8-yard gain. And the reason why North Carolina State is able to get the ball down the field is that the offensive line, who we talked about a little bit ago, has been able to protect Daniel Evans, and he's found open receivers, and when they're open, they're running in space, either crossing routes or post routes where they're running full speed when they catch the football.
Second down and 3. Lots of options now for the Wolfpack offense, and they stick to the ground. Eugene tries to fight his way to the first down marker. Clint sent him on the stop for and Wahoos underneath that pile.
And Doug, let's face it, they've neutralized Chris Long and Jeffrey Fitzgerald. First and second down, you know where those guys are going to be. They don't do a whole lot up front, Virginia. Allen Billiatt, he's the nose tackle, and Fitzgerald and Long or the ends. They stay pretty base. And third and long, they move around, but they haven't been able to get North Carolina State many third and longs today.
So it's third down and a long one. Closer to 2, actually. There you see Long against Remiglio, the freshman. Eugene bust out of it. First down and more. Eugene cuts back. Oh, and he cuts himself down at the 6-yard line, and they'll mark him down at the 3. What a run, Jamel Eugene.
Usually happens when you have everybody up in the box. Usually 9 guys trying to stop the short yardage play. If you get outside, watch Eugene get outside here. He sees, goes inside and takes it up the field. Nate Lyles has outside, but great blocking downfield by who? Daniel Bowens. Donald Bowens, excuse me. Outstanding block. Look at him, and this allows him to cut back outside. If he keeps his feet, he scores a touchdown.
37 on the game, 73 so far for the game total. It is a choppy turf out there. They wouldn't even let the bands operate at halftime. Flag down before the snap.
Looks like the right guard, Curtis Crouch, was offsides. Moving a little early. Either he or Mears Green.
Scott McAwee from the ACC officiating crew with a call.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense, right guard. Yeah. 5-yard penalty, remains first
and this
down.
This is what you hate. You get a great play and watch the right guard. You're going to see him move right there. It was Garrett Klein.
Just a fraction of a second too quick.
Yeah, he was just a quick. I mean, and he, you know, the thing that frustrates you as a coach and offensive line coach is that he's right next to the center. Hey, man, look out of the corner of your eye. Don't jump offside. So I apologize to Curtis Crouch. It was Garrett Klein.
So once again, first and goal. Not as close as they were before. Blackman now lines up. That's what they do with McFadden at Arkansas. And and Blackman just goes out of bounds. That didn't fool anybody.
Nah, that was a short side of the field. Blackman didn't really have anywhere to go. But you know what was smart about Blackman? He didn't try to run around. He just tried to fight for whatever yards he could get.
They call it the Wildcat formation at Arkansas.
But Virginia does a good job of defending it. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven guys. I mean, they all are flying, but look at Donald Bowens blocking downfield. I mean, he is fired up.
Don't you like to see that?
Yeah, receive. I mean, that's what you got to have as a complete receiver. Getting a chance to play today for John Dunlap, doing it in the running and passing game.
Eugene lines up behind Evans. Medics, the fullback, is in there. Into the end zone. Incomplete.
It's trying to go to Marcus Stone. You can see that play developing. In this area is a perfect spot for that tight end. Once he gets off the line, if there's no coverage, watch there on the right side of your screen, and he has an inside position on the safety. Byron Gladsby right there, just couldn't quite get to it.
Ninth play of the drive coming up. Third and goal.
You know, they've been running the ball so effectively, Doug, that 22, Byron Gladsby held just enough so he could get up the field and almost complete that touchdown.
The pump fake, has to throw it out of bounds. Out comes the field goal team.
Marcus Stone just takes out the cameraman and goes over to see if he's okay.
Appears to be okay. He's all smiles. The camera may not be okay.
Let's take a look here. Danger on the job.
Ooh. Wow.
Stone's not a little guy either.
No.
He popped right back up, though. The cameraman was, hey, I'm okay. I got this. I'm all right.
See if Hauschka can continue his remarkable season. 2 for 2 today, 9 for 9 on the season. 23-yard field goal attempt. Oh, that was blocked.
Chris Long.
And it still made it through. Chris Long got his hand on it. And it, hey, when you're a kicker and it goes through like that, you're having a heck of a year.
Well, and you talk about instant offense and creating havoc. Chris Long almost gets one blocked, and maybe they go the other way. Wow.
Chris Long got through. Look at that. Got the hand on it, the left hand. And it still made it through NC State by 6. NC State on top of 15th-ranked Virginia, 23-17. Doug Bell along with Charles Arbuckle and Melissa Knowles on a beautiful Saturday night. It's been a rainy week. Much-needed rain in this area, drought conditions. So from that aspect, it was terrific. From a football aspect, a little soggy today, but it hasn't slowed down NC State. Just a squibber fielded at the 13. Brought up to the 31.
Doug, interesting how Andrew Pearman is carrying the ball like a former Virginia player, Tiki Barber, holding it up high, trying to stay away from any fumble problems that he had. He was having those problems earlier in the year.
Chris Long got his hand in that last field goal, and he got a lot of it. You could hear the pop up here, but this is what he's done. 2 points safety last week against Maryland when he buried the Maryland quarterback in the end zone. The offense only generated a field goal so far in the third quarter this season. Sewell gets another first down for the Cavaliers.
Doug, you can give that credit to the offense, but really it becomes a situation where the kicking team gets those points. So they have just not been able to figure out how to score in the third quarter. They can come out fast and furious in the fourth quarter, and we saw how they finished the half.
Terrific story on Chris Long this week on college game day. Out of the shadow of his father, no question about it. I think he's going to be a better player than his dad. His dad was a Hall of Famer in the NFL. Simpson goes over the left side. Martrell Brown leads the red jerseys. For Virginia, there were a few miscues in the first half.
Beating themselves. That right there, the snap. Little high, but Sewell should have it. Then the interception there. by DeJuan Morgan. And then another low snap. Sewell gets the ball back. And then here, Jeremy Gray, with the interception. This is where North Carolina State has struggled to turn the ball over, and they've gotten two interceptions so far today.
Second down and eight for Jameel Sewell. Has time, not a problem. Out to Simpson. And the turf didn't help him that time. He kind of skidded to a halt. LaRue Rumpf was there.
You know, everybody's struggling with this turf. Both teams. You know, Darrell Blackman, we saw him trying to make a move. And Simpson, that's part of his game where you really try to cut and get up the field. But the minute you do it, your cleats come from out from under you. And you got to know, they are game plan to a hilt against Michael Simpson. They know where he is on every single snap.
Third down. Virginia's been very good on third down today, but not this time. Willie Young
had his first two career sacks last week against East Carolina. Let's give him number three. Long and lean, very good rusher. Has struggled in this defense, but now here's the reason why they're excited about Willie Young. Goes inside, beats Will Barker. I talked about it before. Left-handed quarterback, his backside. You got to do a good job if you're the right tackle. Will Barker struggling a little bit today.
Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. Second-year player Willie Young coming into his own. 6'4", 230. He's built like one of those speed defensive ends. Ryan Wygan on to put it away for the Cavaliers. Off the side of his foot, a low liner. Blackman fields it at the 12. And he's run out of bounds around the 28-yard line.
I like Blackman. See, every time he has, he'll help guys up, he talks to the other guys. I saw him earlier after Long hit him, giving talk, you know, having a friendly conversation. They say he doesn't stop talking.
He's a chatterbox, and right now, look at him. He's talking to his teammate. Watch that. Here it comes, the senior, and here comes the Wolfpack. ESPNU College Football, presented by Allstate, is brought to you by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's. It's a full moon over Raleigh. Boy, it looks like a piece of crystal up in the sky, huh? A gorgeous night to watch some football here at Carter-Finley Stadium. Back to the ground, Jamel Eugene cuts it back, and let's check back in the studio. Mike Leeson, Glee.
Well, Doug, I'm not sure if you want to see this highlight, but no Sean Moreno. 178 yards, three touchdowns now. Good second effort there. And the Bulldogs, 42-30 over Florida. Inside 4 minutes, Doug.
That's just about over. And I would hate to see the celebration for Georgia if they win this one. They celebrated after the first touchdown today. The whole team ran on the field. Daniel Evans. Dangerous pass almost intercepted. Falls incomplete. Looking for Donald Bowens.
Well, Razai Dowling did a very good job of running the route, basically. He stayed in his hip pocket. And then when he decided to make a break, he came underneath. And Daniel Evans thought he had open, and then right there, I mean, that's, you can't ask a defender to make a play better. He knows he has over-the-top help, and he can just stay underneath. He struggled with Bowens. Both corners have struggled with Bowens, but on that play, Razai Dowling did a very good job.
Third down. Daniel Evans, who has that motion to Ty Detmer, wears the same number. In the last couple of weeks, he's put up Detmer-type numbers. This time he goes down.
Yeah, he had
Clint Centum.
And Doug, he had the clock ticking. He knew Centum was coming or Long was coming. And we talked about Razai Dowling. He's getting a chance to play in place of Chris Cook, who's been injured the last few weeks. But right here, this is good pressure. Nate Lyles, it sent him, and then Long was coming around the backside.
From his own end zone, Bradley Pearson. They call him Sticks. See what Sticks can do. Gets it out of there, the left-footed punter. High punt. Fielded at the 44. Bit wobbly on the catch was Vic Hall. But the Cavaliers again will have excellent field position. Their second drive of the third quarter, 47 yards on the punt, and the fair catch. I didn't know it was Throwback Saturday. I haven't seen the wave in about 10 years.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Wow. Crowd trying to entertain themselves during that TV timeout. Pack trying to hang on to this 6-point lead. Sewell wide open. Beautiful catch. Nice throw, Jonathan Stupar. Hey, what a finish we have in store. Let's go to Mike Leeds in the studio to find out more.
That's right. The Bulls of South Florida trailing UConn. Moved inside the five. Their last two drives, one field goal, then this. Fourth down. Grothy overshoots his man, 22-15. UConn with just 31 seconds to go, Doug.
Wow. South Florida's going to lose two in a row.
Yeah, we talked about, was UConn that good after we saw him a few weeks ago?
Unbelievable. They lost to this Virginia team by one in Charlottesville. That time, Sewell throws two low to Stupar. Since joining the Bulls subdivision, look at that, USF and UConn. USF a little bit better, and yet UConn is going to win today and play Rutgers next week.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's just, this year is just so crazy. And you knew South Florida from a few years ago had been able to play and upset some teams, but UConn just had everyone scratching their head when they were undefeated.
Setting up the screen. I was going to Keith Payne.
Yeah, James Martin timed that perfectly. Middle linebacker, he's had a good game today. Pompano Beach, Florida, Eli High School.
Yeah, a young man who really just battled injuries throughout his entire career. He hasn't gone one season without being nicked up in some capacity, but he's playing well right now.
Having a good senior year. Virginia Club is just, their offense in the third quarter. You watch them on film, it looks that way, and you can't just put your finger on it. It's a multitude of things.
Haven't generated a touchdown all year in the third quarter. 6 of 11 on third down conversion. Over the middle. That's going to come up short. Andrew Pierman gets thrown down by J.C. Neal.
And you can just sit back and allow. You see, you have four or five guys in the vicinity where he catches the football. He's going to come on a drag route, but he has to catch it underneath because they're not going to allow you to get deeper than him. One, two, three. You got big Martrell Brown flying down to come and hit you. It's tough to pick up first downs when you have a long third down against this North Carolina State defense.
Chris Goldine, he does the short punting. In fact, five times this year he's put one inside the 20-yard line. 5 out of 7, actually. Pretty good numbers and a pretty good weapon. Let's see if this. Yes, the fair catch at the 10-yard line by Blackman. So the Pack will start deep in their own territory. Remember, coming up later tonight on ESPNU, it's Bobby Bowden's FSU Seminoles against the Duke Blue Devils, primetime college football presented by Citi on ESPNU, 8 Eastern. Tomorrow, women's college soccer. Two of the best teams in the country, Santa Clara number 11 and Portland number 6. Women's soccer on ESPNU Sunday at 5 Eastern.
You know, Doug, this is an important drive for North Carolina State because this is an area where you have to kind of distance yourself from Virginia. They struggle in the third quarter. Get you some points. You know they're going to finish fast.
Evans looks left, goes right. Donald Bowens, up within 2 yards of the first down. Let's find out what's happening with Longhorns and Cornhuskers. Mike Leeson in the studio.
Well, Doug, I said earlier, Nebraska was in dire need of an upset, and it looked like they might get it until Jamal Charles breaks this one 86 yards down the far sideline, and this will give Texas the 21-17 lead. 6:09 to go in the ball game, Doug.
Boys in burnt orange, boy, if they had lost to Nebraska, wow.
Not over yet. Yeah. Texas trying to move up on Notre Dame on the all-time wins list. Evans throws that out of bounds and then takes a shot from Jeffrey Fitzgerald.
You know, Doug, but what you notice with Evans is he stays calm. He doesn't panic, and he knows he's going to take a shot, but he still gets the ball out of bounds. You know, he looks down this side, doesn't see anyone, goes back in the middle, can't find anyone there, knows I got to get rid of the football. That clock is going off in his head. And that comes from playing more, planning this offense, getting comfortable with what Dana Bible is calling.
He does have that internal clock. Yeah, you see it time and time again.
Yeah, he just, at the right time, he gets rid of it. He knows longest. You can sense it up here.
Third down and a long two. Evans on the rollout. Nobody there trying to run for it, and he takes a pop. And he will be short. Antonio Appleby just wrapped him up and threw him down.
Well, that time he kind of braced. He should have just ran for the sideline because Appleby is a good athlete, former high school tight end, good basketball player. He brings it right there. Big guy. Has a cast on his hand. Looks like a thumb injury. But when we were on the field before the game, I was impressed with how big and how athletic he was.
So again, kicking from the goal line. Old Sticks Pearson. Gets it off. McCall lets that bounce. And NC State will down it at the 35-yard line. And once again, Buck, no points for UVA in this third quarter. It's somewhat of a perplexing situation. For some reason, they just bogged down coming out of the locker room.
They do. It's like you wonder, why don't they go back in like it's the first quarter and just assume the game has started from the beginning? Because every third quarter, they do the same thing. But you know what they do well? Their defense does a good job against other teams' offenses. Even though they give up points, they stay in the game. They keep the game close.
Let's see what happens. They're going to have to rally again. If you're a Virginia fan, hey, nothing new about this. Season long. Here comes Simpson now. Simpson started off quickly in the first quarter, and he's bogged down like the rest of the offense here as of late.
This North Carolina State defense, you know, we talked about it even with Louisville. Remember, they play very well. They don't allow you to do the things that you're comfortable with. Mike Archer has had, you know, great runs wherever he's been. He was a head coach at LSU, a defensive coordinator for a number of years at the college level at Kentucky the last 4 years. He does a very good job of getting his guys ready to play.
Short of Simpson. And he runs right into a wall of red jerseys. Big number 92, DeMario Presley, was there.
And Doug, that's a prime example of being in position and being ready to play. A lot of times today, they slant. Look how that line slants and gets away. They don't try to man up these big old offensive linemen, so they use their quickness. Mike Archer getting his guys in space. Instead of stemming like some teams do right before the snap, they just moved on the snap, and DeMario Presley was a beneficiary of that movement.
Grow, looking at that playlist, listening to what his son Mike Grow is calling. Crowd turned up the volume. Here comes Sewell. Trying to get to the first down marker, and he does. Great individual effort by Jameel Sewell. Thomas Barnes finally gets the stop on him, but he just cut back. He knew where the marker was.
That's what he gives you. You know, the play breaks down, and you can see Barnes looking for him. C43 right there looking for him. LaRump Rue can't really run. LaRue Rump can't run effectively 52, and he's trying to get in position. Yeah, and Thomas Barnes, the freshman, trying to take his head off.
And the Cavaliers, they're not nervous. No sweat on the mascot. Coming from behind is their MO this season. Here comes the blitz. They picked it up. Sewell fires it. Too hard and too high. Looking for Maurice Covington, who was in the slot. DeJuan Morgan, as Mike Archer shuffled the secondary for NC State going in today, I think they've done a nice job.
Yeah, I think they have. They've really done a good job of getting, you know, with the interceptions alone.
Well, here are the close wins this season. Could it be one more? Five wins of 6 points or less, most in Division I this year.
Well, Al Groh said it. Hey, as long as we finish with more points than the other guys, it's a win, right?
Sewell with time. Again, looking for Covington. Covington kind of stopped as he saw the defender coming at him.
No, Doug, it just looks like this Virginia offense in the third quarter, the two games we've done as well as watching them the weeks before, just kind of bogged down. It's almost like a boxer taking, you know, a seventh or eighth round break, just catching his breath on offense. Their defense stays fast and furious,
offensively, they haven't learned how to come out at halftime and make the adjustments right away.
The Cavaliers 7 of 13 on third down so far today. Sewell looking long, has a man. Overshoots Staten Job.
Nice speed. Yeah, he's fast and a walk on here. Just couldn't quite connect.
Get over here,
Brandon Albert, the all-ACC left guard, he said, hey, we're not a sexy team. We're not going to go deep on you every play. We can be sexy or not. It doesn't matter as long as we keep on winning.
Who's bringing sexy back? Is Brandon Albert bringing it back? Big 71. Big sexy.
The Big B. He is a funny guy.
He's co-captain of this team, has come back and really done a good job for this offensive line.
Again, running again to the Cavs. A high play sends Blackman into the end zone. He fumbles it. Has to run it out because I think he was actually in the playing field. And he fumbles the football. And NC State will pounce on it at the two-yard line.
He almost had an insult to injury there. I mean, that could have been just a horrible play. And still, we don't know who has the ball, but if NC State has it. And Doug, this is one of those ones where you got to stop at the 10 and not go back. And once he went back, he had to take it out. I've got him using that last little second effort to get it out of the end zone.
I'm not sure if he'd have gone down on one knee, they wouldn't let him have it on the 20. That was close.
Yeah. But what I think he thought in his mind, I'm here, I better get out. And I think he lost sense of where he was as well. Didn't know where he caught it.
That was so close, I think they would have given him the touchback. But we'll never know. And from the 2-yard line now, here comes the Wolfpack. Time is winding down in this third quarter. Under 2 minutes, wide open on the outside. Who else? Donald Bowens. Run out of bounds by Byron Glaspie.
You know why it happens also, Doug? Donald Bowens and Daniel Evans have been second team for most of the year. They practice a lot together with the second unit. They've been on the scout team together. So when they get a chance to play, you can see how they've been able to connect. He's very comfortable with Donald Bowens, even though he has not been the starter.
Big numbers for Bowens today, 9 for 144. Came in with five catches, 93 yards against ECU, which was a career high.
And had 15 receptions on the year.
And that will go for a first down. Tom O'Brien has the headset on. Of course, Tom O'Brien's son Daniel is a GA at Alabama, and Nick Saban and the Crimson Tide, they've had some close calls. They've had an exciting season, not quite as exciting as Virginia, but pretty close. He's been talking to his son, and Daniel's been telling him all about it. Evans just throws it out of bounds. Ran out of real estate. Let's check back in the studio. Mike Gleason, please.
And Doug, we check on Texas and Nebraska. Jamal Charles, we saw him go 86. Well, here he goes, 40. 264 yards, 3 touchdowns. That's 11 now. Second to Javorski Lane, 28-17, Texas. Doug.
All right, flexing their muscles, the Longhorns.
Talk about instant offense, though, Jamal Charles.
Woo. Hey, I noticed Buffalo won again today. They're 3-0 in the MAC conference. So if Nebraska's looking for a coach, who knows, maybe Turner Gill could wind up at his alma mater. Good stick by Vic Hall. We heard it all the way up here. Let's check in with Melissa Knowles. Melissa, what you got?
You know, Tom O'Brien is known for wanting to make his players very well-rounded. He has his coach's credo, where he wants his players to be champions in the classroom, champions in the community, and champions on the practice field. Guys?
That's something that he learned having been at the Naval Academy and graduating from there and then spending so much time there, and then with George Welsh at Virginia. And it's kind of the blueprint he learned from Steve Belichick as well. Bill Belichick's dad when he was at Navy. Evans, the outside, batted down. And there's your man once again. Mr. Dowling. Boy, he's had a good game.
He really has. He struggled a little bit earlier in the pass coverage, but has come on in the third quarter. Nice play. Could have, if he could have been there a step sooner, may have had a pick six. But once again, one of those young guys getting a chance to come in and play when other people get injured.
He had a nice game against UConn, the game we called at Charlottesville a couple weeks ago. Pearson, he's been very busy playing again. That ball breaks free. Flags down the play. He was interfered with trying to catch that football.
You know, Vic Hall started out the season really well, and then he's really struggled in the kicking game, catching those punts. Now he's going to get a reprieve, I think, here. Didn't have enough room to catch that football.
Brandon Woods did recover it for Virginia, but that will go against NC State.
You got to give the returner a chance to catch the football.
Interference with the opportunity to catch the kick. Kicking team, number 14, 15 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
You know, and irregardless if you are calling a fair catch or not, he has to catch the football before you hit him. You got to time it up where you stop and then restart and hit him.
J.C. Neal blocked Chris Gorham. Back into him. We've seen that twice this year where even though his own man hit him,
yep,
he was blocked into it by the defender.
But there were two of them also, which is a little bit different.
10 different receivers have caught passes from Jamil Sewell. That's the second time this season it's happened for UVA. Third time it's happened. To the outside. Dontrell Inman. Gain of six. DeAndre Morgan on the stop for NC State.
You know, Inman is an interesting story. Missed the last half of the senior year and was still highly recruited out of Batesburg, South Carolina. But here's a guy, man, they say has a lot of talent, a true freshman, 6'1", 6'3", 185. Al Groh says when he walks on the field, like he's the man.
And when he got injured, people backed off. UVA stayed on him. There's Simpson. Jonah Spurt gets tripped up down at the 25. DeJuan Morgan got the ankle just at the last possible time before he turned the corner.
It's getting close to the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
Offense can feel it. 9 seconds. They know it's coming.
It really has been remarkable. With all the comeback victories and all the excitement this year, the offense has been shut out of touchdowns this season.
I'd like to see Mike Groh go to the end zone right now and exercise that curse of third quarter woes for the offense.
UVA with 20 first downs. Back to the ground. Simpson gets it up to the 20, maybe the 19. And that is the end of the third quarter. Not a lot of action compared to that second quarter, but it's still close. Too close to call in Raleigh. Goose egg in the third quarter.
You know what?
Look at the goose egg in the third quarter. Not a surprise. Offense has generated no touchdowns this season, but, Buck, they've owned the fourth quarter.
Oh, they have.
So look out, especially the last 2 or 3 minutes.
Well, I said, when NC State didn't capitalize on their slow ability or non-ability to get touchdowns, that's going to make for an interesting game in the fourth quarter because, you know, Virginia, they've been in this situation a lot.
So as we head into the fourth quarter, Virginia leads in the rushing department. And that usually is a telltale sign in this series. Simpson goes over the left side and goes nowhere. I've been impressed by the NC State defense from when we saw them against Louisville 4 weeks ago to now. Yeah. Improved tremendously.
Well, and not only the defense, but the offense, the whole team, the atmosphere of this team. It's just a totally different situation, and the fans as well. They have really gotten behind this ball club, even though they struggled this year.
On their feet, on third down, the Cardiac Cavaliers, they have another comeback in them. Sewell, under deflection, Simpson with the grab, gets close to the first down. Allen Michael Cash on the stop. And Sewell is down back at the 36, getting up rather gingerly.
Well, you come from that backside, and once again, Nate Irving, get to him, and you have pressure coming. Mykel Simpson, I don't know how he caught this football, and I don't know how Sewell got it off. Good tip right there by DeMario Presley, looks like. And then Sewell was shaken up on that play.
It's fourth down.
But you know, he was hurt last week. He came out of the game for about two plays, and Peter Lalek had to come and take his place because he got the wind knocked out of him or something. He was just shaken up.
They're 5 out of 8 on fourth down conversions this season. Timeout, Jamil Sewell.
You can see that coming. The clock was going down. They had problems getting the play in. On fourth down, you want to make sure you understand what you're going to do on that next play.
So as the coaches talk it over, we want to tell you about ESPNU.com, an online service which is the gateway to the best in college sports. And if you don't have ESPNU, be sure to log on to ESPNU.com and type in your zip code at the top of the page, or call your local cable operator or satellite provider. Log on to ESPNU.com today. Both teams with two timeouts remaining. A lot of time in this fourth quarter. For Virginia, they need to keep on winning. And who knows, maybe that Virginia-Virginia Tech game could decide who goes to the ACC championship.
Well, you know, they both could be 0 and whatever. They'd still be ready to fight.
That could have added advantage.
Yeah, it really could. Really could.
But the Cavaliers need to keep drinking that magic potion. Because whatever that they've been drinking, it's been working.
It's really found a way to just finish ball games.
Grow sweatshirt pulled up above the elbows. Fourth down. Sewell keeps it himself. Tippy toes down the sidelines. Run out of bounds at the 5-yard line by DeJuan Morgan, and he comes up limping. He took a hit from DeJuan Morgan.
Yeah, he took a shot earlier from Nate Irving, and you can see that bracelet on his leg, and we noticed it, you know, before the play. It, right there, look at him. He's going to come down, and DeJuan Morgan just lays a shot on him. Kind of makes him, he kind of twists his knee or ankle at the very end there. Before the game, we noticed that brace. I didn't see it the last game we did.
First and goal.
It's under review.
All right, so the last play is under review as far as the spot. And Sewell will limp to the sidelines. You know, he's a speed guy, Buck, and he doesn't wear knee pads. Those the uniform's pulled up above the knees, but he does have that. Oh, it looks like he stepped out of bounds back maybe around the 12-yard line.
Let's see, right. Yeah, didn't look like it on that one. The other angle, you thought so right there, but that sideline view did not show that. Doesn't look like it there. Yeah, he just got really close. Yeah.
Great camera work, and that is what the review team is looking at upstairs.
Second time he's done that. Remember in the third quarter, he picked up a first down after you thought he was going to go out, but man, he came down awkwardly on his leg.
Here he comes right at you. Now watch him tippy toe and do the tightrope thing right down the sidelines. Yep.
After review, the call on the field is confirmed. The runner did not step out of bounds. First.
So again, it'll be first and goal, just shy of, we'll call it right on the 5-yard line.
You know, one thing with Jamil Sewell is that they want him to get even better at studying film, extra film. He's such a good athlete that he was so used as he was growing up to just going out and playing football, basketball, baseball. You tell he's just a very good athlete. But they also want him to just continue to get better and understanding what defenses are coming, what they're doing to him. And he's only a sophomore, got a lot of time.
Mykel Simpson lines up behind Sewell. Here comes Simpson over the left side. Big hole, stretches in. Touchdown, Virginia.
Well, that big offensive line, we talked about it, just wearing you out. And then Virginia just seems to wake up. Oh, okay, it's the fourth quarter. All right, now it's time to turn it on.
Made it look easy.
Yeah, look at that good blocking up front. We see Ian Yates Cunningham again. And wherever he's going, if you follow him, you have a chance to get into the end zone. Watch Big 77. Even if he doesn't do anything, he just gets in the way. Got enough of Willie Young. I mean, he scares you when you see Big 77 coming at you. And it made...
The previous play is under review.
They're going to review to see if the ball broke the plane before his knee came down. And from the first replay we showed, I thought he broke the plane.
I thought so also. But once again, Cunningham has two blocks here, one on Ernest Jones and one on Willie Young. Look at Big 77. Man, imagine him coming at you. What are you going to do? So he gets enough for Jones and then goes up to Young. And then right there, he's on. Knee goes in.
Well, the left knee is down, but I think the ball was over.
Right. Looks like the ball is over before the knee goes down. Yep.
And again, you go back to last week at the end of the Maryland game.
Oh, yeah.
And Ralph Frege in the fridge ran onto the field, did not think he broke the plane. This is our best angle. And again, these are the angles the replay team is watching upstairs right now.
See, the line judge is going, working his way down as well. He's the one that made the call, the guy with the L that you saw right in front of the screen. Was Sterling Allen.
When his left knee came down, his body and the ball was in the end zone.
But on that replay, you see the line judge, and I think that's a touchdown.
I think it's going to be a touchdown as well. Here's Scott McAuley.
After review, the call on the field stands. The ball crossed the goal line before the runner's knee was down. It's a touchdown.
So the extra point will give the Cavaliers their first lead of the day. Chris Gold on. Senior, whose older brother kicks for the Chicago Bears. Not a problem. And the Cavaliers, with 13:12 on the clock, take their first lead, 24-23. Mikel Simpson, big man on campus, with a stretch and the score. On a homecoming Saturday, you'd have to expect a red moon right above NC State. That is wild looking, or maybe it was a pumpkin, a big pumpkin in the sky. Short kick. Virginia recovers it. Flag down to the play.
And the area where they dropped the flag, it looks like offsides on the kicking team. So that might come back.
So recovered by Hal Simmons. Yep. And that's going to come back.
Now watch here. You're going to get a chance to see. Yeah, they're clearly offsides. Multiple people.
Offsides. Kicking team. Number 9. 5-yard penalty where he kicked from the 25-yard line.
Yeah,
they call it on the kicker.
Yeah. But his buddies were, I mean, it looked like the whole team was offside.
Check that, 19. All number right, 19.
They checked that. It wasn't on Chris Gold.
Well, that's high dolling. But it could have called it on about 5 or 6 different people. The kicker looked like he changed up his approach on that one.
And Darrell Blackman again, who made that questionable decision in the end zone, let that one bounce right off his leg.
Yeah, Chris Gold kind of changed up his approach. He did that on field goals. He moved from a 3-step to a 2-step. 2-step. Approach with his brother in the offseason. Blackman has to be better in the receiving game.
Blackman lets Bowens field this one at the 5. He'll block for him. Look at Bowens. Oh, he loses the football and it goes out of bounds.
That was Chris Gold with the tackle.
The kicker.
Man, he got his head across it. A good job.
Hey, it all started back on September 15th. 2-point win against Carolina. A week later, 5-point win against Georgia Tech. October 6th, they rallied in the final seconds
to beat Middle Tennessee. We called the UConn game, and it looked like UConn was going to go in for the winning score. A couple of bad snaps. And then last week against Maryland, did he cross or did he not? The official said he did.
On that look, it looked like he got in.
Back-to-back one-point wins, second time in ACC history. Eugene had a gap and just couldn't keep his feet.
You know, Doug, we're talking so much about Virginia coming from behind, but maybe it's North Carolina State who's looking for a chance to build on what they did last week. Watch this hit by Chris Gold. Kicker.
Wow. Whoa, wow.
That was a great shot. Then he gets up. Watch him. This is good. He doesn't get to do this much. He pops up like, let's go.
He'll be in the film room next week with the special teams guys. Evans, the Blackman, who goes backwards. Big Jeffrey Fitzgerald.
But look
at the arms around him.
Doug, look at the intensity now. The defense, it was already high in the third quarter. When they get a few points, they just seem to just turn it up another notch. And Long again trying to get in there. Good throw to Blackman. They're trying to get him some catches over the middle. Jeffrey Fitzgerald. Everybody else is right there just trying to cause some havoc.
Long came back, got a piece of him. I mean, he is always going strong. 5 out of 13 now on third downs for the Wolfpack. Third down and 8. Daniel Evans. They have been real quiet in this second half. Over the middle, it was tight end. First down, Marcus Stone.
That was a good play by Daniel Evans. They were coming with the corner blitz. Razai Dowling was coming from that side. They had overabundance of guys coming from the one side. So what does he do? He throws in that area because he knows tight end. Hot release, comes off the line, knows he's got to help the quarterback out, catches the ball, gets a first down. Good job by Stone. Good recognition by Daniel Evans.
Boy, Stone has had a nice day. He's made some difficult catches. It's first and 10 now in Virginia territory. Eugene, this long, initially had him, and he worked his way out of that tackle. And then Lyles finally brought him down.
Doug, that's what you do. I mean, Evans is finding the area. When you come with the blitz, you're tight end, you know someone's going to be hot. The hot receiver was at tight end. They got that one. Jamel Eugene, now he gets 3 or 4 yards. They're putting a nice drive together, North Carolina State is.
Tom O'Brien watching. Daniel Evans maneuver this offense. It's another first down. Completed pass to the outside.
Coyell George
caught that touchdown earlier. His first touchdown grab.
Sophomore out of Havelock, North Carolina. And Evans again getting comfortable. And George was working on Jermaine Dice. That's a mismatch. Receiver on a linebacker.
First and 10 now for the Pack. Evans looking left. Once again, going to 33. Coyell George.
Long was right there as he was trying to release the football. Didn't let him get through. Didn't let him follow through with it. But Daniel Evans is staying calm and cool in the pocket, not getting too rattled, even when pressure's getting to him.
Second and 10, trying to work their way in field goal range for Hauschka. Dangerous pass that is picked off.
You keep trying to attack me, Razai Dowling says, I'm going to get you. And that was one of those plays where you talk about a very good athlete. Played DB, wide receiver, running quarterback in high school. Long athlete. Look at him. Knows cover two. I got help over the top. I just come. I'm a settle. Nothing to hold him down. Look, pick the ball off.
First turnover for the Wolfpack. And look at that. At least one turnover every game against the Cavs since 1963.
Some teams just bring out the worst in you.
O'Brien watching. Wolfpack will get the ball back, certainly. Quickly to the outside. Another first down. Staten Job, young man from Austin, Texas, who's one of three walk-ons who are starting for this Virginia team.
Austin Westlake High School, where Drew Brees is from. But good job of getting the ball down the field. And the thing about Stan Job, he came here before his senior year of football camp at Virginia and got an opportunity to walk on, a preferred walk-on like Al Groh was.
Second and one. Simpson surges forward for the first down. Ted Larson on the stop for NC State.
You know, now this offensive line and this offensive group wants to just wear down North Carolina State, use as much clock and force them into a situation if they can come away with the field goal or touchdown, leave them with as little time as possible. They're not moving as quickly, taking their time and just marching down the field.
Staying on the ground. Simpson goes nowhere. Nate Irving, another stop. He's had a big night for NC State.
Well, Doug, it was interesting. They went to a huddle. They were slowly huddled. Then they ran to the line, kind of changed the tempo a little bit, caught North Carolina State. They thought off guard, but Nate Irving, I mean, he has just been making plays the last few weeks.
Jamil has gone to 11 different receivers. First time this season that the Cavs have spread the wealth that much. They stay on the ground. Simpson, boy, he's fast. He shifts into that extra gear, and the special ones had that extra gear, Buck, as you know.
He hadn't been able to turn up the field like he wants to, but even still, got enough at the field side so he can run almost to the sideline and still pick up 7-8 yards. But he does have a burst. And you've got to understand, this North Carolina State defense knows. They knew where five was. They game plan. They put five on everything to say, we've got to stop him. Mikel Simpson can't beat us like he did Maryland.
He's up to 81 yards on 21 carries. That goes incomplete. They weren't on the same wavelength that time.
Yeah, Kerry Cope running down the field. Jamel Sewell thought he had him, thought he was going to come back.
So it's fourth down in a punting situation. Ryan Wygand on for Virginia, excuse me. Lots of time for the Wolfpack. To 23 by Blackman, looking for a wall. He's got some room, and finally he's brought down around the 39 for Virginia. That was John Phillips getting down there in special teams to make the stop. Nail-biting time in Raleigh. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate. Are you in good hands? Guys in the truck are having way too much fun.
Not as much fun as Cavaliers.
NC State right back at it. Eugene goes down, and Dowling makes another stop. Razai Dowling, wow. I mean, he's had a huge game today.
He really has. And, you know, guys like Mike Parker, who was supposed to play for, you know, Kerry Cook. You know, when guys get hurt here at Virginia, they just keep putting different people in. And Razai Dowling is getting a chance to play, and he's playing very well.
There's the total yards. NC State outgaining Virginia, but now behind on the scoreboard. Evans throws it up for grabs, and it is caught. What a grab
on
the outside.
Owen Spencer.
Wow.
The freshman out of Leland, North Carolina. That eastern coast over there, close to Wilmington. And Daniel Evans giving his receiver a chance. Young receiver, tall, able to go up. Now, Razai Dowling can make some plays, but you can also get burned. You got to be ready as a defensive back to take the good with the bad.
Well, if you're an NC State fan, you have to be excited about these freshmen. I mean, these are names of the future that are making plays now. Edwards into the end zone. Touchdown, NC State. Donald Bowens, no flags, and the Wolfpack back on top.
Well, we talked about how well Dowling was playing, but he also had gotten beat. And they went, Dana Bible just says, okay. And he didn't have a problem calling the same. But remember he told us, if a play is working, I'm going to keep going back to it. That's the second time they went right at him and marched down the field and answered. We said, can they come back? They showed it right there. Dowling was in position, but Daniel Evans again. Look where the receiver catches the ball. He just over his shoulder, comes up with a nice catch.
They'll go for two, the Wolfpack. In hopes of going up by seven, Bowens, 10 catches, 174 yards, and two touchdowns. What a night. Evans looks into the end zone. It's a jump ball. And he just threw it too far and too wide. So a five-point lead now for the Wolfpack with 7:37 on the clock. What a night. We've had a little bit of everything. We've had a red moon above the stadium, and now the moon is gone. And we've had Donald Bowens. Poof! Last week it was Michael Simpson of Virginia who came out of nowhere. And how about number 80, Donald Bowens? 10 catches, 174 yards. Never had a 100-yard receiving game before today, and he's could wind up with 200 plus yards, who knows? Never had 10 catches in a game before today. Wow. Remember the name. Fumble kickoff. And here they come. Seidenberg knocked out of bounds at the 28. Josh Seidenberg muffed the first when he first caught it, then made some good yardage.
Usually when this happens, the defense slows down just enough, and once he gets the ball, watch, he's going to take off. And he's going to just take on the last man to try to get him, Seidenberg. The last two that tried to get him.
So here come the Cavaliers.
Last 3 weeks, Jamel Sewell, 14 of 15. On the game-winning drive, 7:28 could be that time.
Sewell, lots of time. Ball is deflected. Willie Young got the big paw up there. Young man from Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. All these young players for NC State are coming up big tonight.
Well, their defense is doing a very good job of sliding over, getting over out of the way and making plays. 97, Willie Young, watching there. But you see 77 in the middle of the screen, he's blocking. That's Ian Yates Cunningham against DeMario Presley. He slid back about 3 yards, so wet.
Second down and 10, and the crowd is into it. Making a lot of noise. Sewell gets run down by Allen Michael Cash. You know, throwing for a loss.
Doug, I think Sewell also couldn't move as effectively. He's still a little bit nicked up from when he was hurt on the last drive. And he's down now.
We have an official timeout for
injury.
Looks
like he's cramping up.
Peter Lalek on the sidelines getting loose. He's the best 6'5" freshman.
Usually when they pull your leg back like that, trying to work on those cramps.
Sewell now 24 of 43, 260 yards.
You know, the North Carolina State defense did a good job. Presley first getting in his face and then just stayed in front. See how all those guys are just trying to stay in front? You have one, two, three, four, five people just waiting and looking to come off their men. And that's tough for a quarterback who's used to running and get out in open space. That was a good play by Allen Michael Cash. So keep him contained, just using the sideline and waiting on James Martin to come and help him out.
So quite a day, a couple of touchdowns, two picks, though. Peter Lalek will come on. He's played quite a bit this season. He's had some experience.
Well, and early in the season, they thought Lalek was going to be their guy. It reminded them a lot of Matt Schaub, and, you know, they wanted him to, if Sewell didn't play better than he did in Wyoming, to step up.
And he's early in the season, they split a little bit of the games. He worked and played quite a bit.
Wallach will come on for a 3rd-and-11 situation. Coming up after our game, more ACC action. It's the Duke Blue Devils against the Seminoles of Florida State. Saturday primetime college football presented by Citi on ESPNU tonight at 8 Eastern. Tomorrow, the best in women's college soccer only on ESPNU. Number 11, Santa Clara. Number 6, Portland. It's women's soccer on ESPNU Sunday at 5 Eastern. So Jamil goes to the sidelines, and look at that uniform. Man.
Oh, man.
He has been working today as he limps to the sidelines, and here comes Peter Lalik.
Look at Lalik. He said, well, let's go. Clean jersey.
Yeah. From the gun. Good snap. Lalik gets hit just as he releases it. And it's incomplete.
Willie Young with another pressure. And you got a right-handed quarterback coming in, but it doesn't matter where the pressure's coming from. Look at Willie Young with a spin move. Great spin move, a la. Man, that was a great play right there. I mean, he just really spun right by Will Barker. Looked like Dwight Freeney.
He did.
Man.
Wygant on now for a very important punt. Blackman back at the 37. This homecoming crowd is making a lot of noise. Beautiful punt. Sends Blackman back to the 24. Wall set up the right side. Trying to get there. And he gets tripped up.
Got to stop Blackman.
Wygant, the punter, makes the tackle. We saw a cold, and now Wygant answers. Here's the ACC standings. BC with a victory on Thursday. Wake Forest, a victory today. That's how the top shakes out in the Atlantic Division. The coastal side, Virginia trying to stay in front of Virginia Tech.
See NC State down there at the bottom, but trying to get a conference win, which has been so hard for them to get over the last couple of years.
Tom O'Brien told his team before the East Carolina game, second half is ours. Let's set a goal. We went out, we go to a bowl game. And they played great against East Carolina, and they play a solid game today. To the ground it goes, trying to run the clock. Eugene to the right side. Antonio Appleby on the tackle.
No, not Eugene. No, Mike Ellis.
Boy, this is one of those nights. All the players limping a bit on that wet turf.
Yeah.
And a lot of, look at Eugene kind of holding that hammy area. Flag down on the play, and it goes against the Wolfpack. Illegal shift.
Well, when you're accustomed to being able to move quickly and the ground comes from underneath you, tough, especially for the shifty guys.
Illegal shift, offense. The wideout was not set with the team for 1 second prior to the snap. 5-yard penalty, first down.
See, those are mental errors that you don't need when you're trying to put a ball game away. You know, this team at North Carolina State has been accustomed over the last few years of having some talented players, but not playing from the neck up. I think Tom O'Brien has changed that mantra. You can see East Carolina, they weathered the storm. Even though they didn't win at Florida State, that seemed like the start of it to me. And now they are in a position to beat a Virginia team that's been red hot.
That's what Jamel has done, 88 yards on the ground. The rest of the team has not fared so well. This time over the left side. He gets stood up by Chris Long. Long disrupts so many things. You don't call his name for a while, but that doesn't mean he's not in there getting a hit here or there or messing up things. I mean, he's disruptive on that side.
Well, usually he has two guys on him almost every play, and then sometimes there's three people that will try to come in contact, and he's still able at times to beat two or three blockers.
More sacks than 18 teams this season. And of course, Al Groh thinks the world of this young man and just cannot heap enough praise on his shoulders.
Evans.
Talk about a DB in closing speed. Look how quickly Long got to him.
And Chris Long, a flag thrown as Long throws down the quarterback. The late hit on the quarterback against Chris Long.
What's the number? Intentional grounding.
Oh.
Number 9 of the offense. The penalty is loss of down at the spot of the foul. Third down.
But the thing here is that he get outside of the tackle box, and now the ball did not get past the line of scrimmage. That's what the key is here. He doesn't get it past the line of scrimmage, so they have to make that call. If he could just throw it 5-10 more yards, and it wouldn't be a penalty.
When I saw the flag go down and then I saw Long talking to the official, I said, I can't believe they called that a late hit. And Long couldn't believe it either, but it went against NC State.
But did you see the closing speed? We talk about that for a defensive back, how quickly he got there once he decided, I'm getting you, Daniel Evans.
The big thing there, that's a loss of down. So it's third down and a country mile, and they'll go to the ground. Eugene has some space. Boy, a big game for Eugene.
He got a country half mile on
that. Yeah, he sure did.
Good blocking downfield. Jarvis Williams. But not quite enough. Good run by Eugene.
Picked up 20 yards. He now has 110 yards on the day and 20 carries. He had 101 against Florida State, so that's his biggest output. Sticks Pearson on for the Wolfpack. Takes a sideways bounce. And down to around the 33-yard line. You know, Al Groh spent a lot of years with the New York Giants. Those great teams coached by Bill Parcells. And Groh was an assistant under Bill Belichick on the defensive side. He said, I only have had the pleasure of coaching one other player in 40 years that was as dominant in his position as Chris, 56.
Yeah.
And he was referring to LT.
Well, I'll tell you, Chris Long should be mentioned for Heisman Trophy as a Heisman Trophy candidate. It doesn't go to defensive guys. Charles Woodson is the last one. But he causes so much havoc, play in and play out.
Wallach still in there, quarterback. Just too high for Stanton Job. Willie Young again on the pressure on Lalek.
Let me say something, Doug. Now, Willie Young has heard all week about how good Chris Long is. Last week, he had a great game. This week, he's having another tremendous game on both sides. He's going against Eugene Monroe, who Chris Long feels is just as good as the Brickenshaw Ferguson, and he got to him on that side. He went to Willie Barker's side. He is just playing like a man possessed for North Carolina State.
Let's see if Lalek can become a hero for this Virginia team. Has some time now. That ball's batted down. I think that was DeMario Presley. Got his hand up. The senior out of Greensboro.
You know, Doug, the other thing is, now you know the quarterback isn't as mobile as Sewell, so you can really pin your ears back and go. Presley, great play by a defensive lineman. When you can't get to the quarterback, hands up, block the ball. But now they know they can just come off and sprinter stands and go after Lawler.
Look at this defense. They're bouncing around, and the crowd have really gotten into it. They're fired up. Wallach, with time, goes deep, has his man off the fingertips. That was so close. Kerry Cope was there. Oh!
I mean, just one more step, and Kerry Cope has the first down, and Lalek throws a nice ball here, not having really had a chance to be on the field other than that last series. He beats DeAndre Morgan by a step.
On comes Ryan Wygan. Seventh punt today for the senior from Pasadena, California. Leads the ACC over 46 yards a kick. He's been effective today. That was a long kick. Off the side of his foot just when you brag about him.
Like a free throw shooter.
I mean, he just came over the top of that one. In golf, you'd say he smothered it out of bounds left. We're live.
in Raleigh, North Carolina, Carter-Finley Stadium, where the Wolfpack is trying for the upset over number 15, Virginia. Doug Bell, along with Charles Arbuckle, Melissa Knowles. The Cavaliers have never won 8 in a row in a single season. It's been a while since NC State has won an ACC game. Coming up next, more ACC action, Duke, FSU.
Back to the ground. Eugene runs right to the arms of Chris Long.
You know what I like about that play by Eugene, though? He attacked Chris Long. He got under his pads and just really tried to take him back and was able to pick up some yards. And some people say, well, why is he dancing? But, man, when he decides to go to the hole, he hits it. And here's a guy that comes off and makes you pay for it.
Now, look at Long's knee pads. You see, Bucky cuts those things off.
Oh, yeah. For speed.
Just above the kneecap. He's got a little protection, not much.
He's built for speed. Them knee pads won't protect you anyway. I mean, it just helps you from getting a little bruise on your knee.
And speed is his game. A large man, 285 pounds. Eugene left side. Nope, great fake. Goes to Marcus Stone. And he gets collared.
Good play by Appleby. He hadn't called his name a lot, but he's made some key plays. Now they put you in third down. But here's a good play. Fitzgerald right there doesn't allow him to get outside. And Appleby. Now, see, that's good sound football. You have everybody accounted for. The quarterback rolling out, you have him accounted for. The receiver coming out, the tight end, you have him accounted for. And then if you don't tackle him, you have Glaspie and the two other guys coming up behind. Long one of them.
All right, Buck, this is big. 6 out of 15 on third downs for the Wolfpack. They're taking their time, but this will go a long way. And this upset attempt, looking for Bowens on the outside. Another grab for the most valuable player of the day, Donald Bowens. His 11th grab, first down, Wolfpack.
I saw Georgia Tech play here last year in North Carolina State. Donald Bowens is trying to imitate Calvin Johnson. Look at this. This is an outstanding play, and you can't cover it any better than Dowling has on that one. Just goes up top and throws the ball and makes a nice play. Donald Bowens is having a coming out party. You can say maybe like Randy Moss as well. Just throw it up. Let him go get it. Outstanding individual effort and good throw again by Donald Evans, giving his receiver a chance to make a play.
Back to the ground, Eugene. They're just trying to run clock.
Clint Simpson may be better watch it there.
Duke, Florida State is coming up right after our game here in Raleigh. It's an ACC doubleheader on ESPNU, and there's the big man today, Donald Bowens.
The second charge timeout of the second half.
Timeout, Virginia. They have one remaining. Bowens had never had a 10-catch game, never had a 100-yard game. 11 grabs, 202 yards.
Well, when you get a chance, you come out and you just do what you do, and that's make plays. Donald Bowens and Daniel Evans putting him in a position to catch the ball and then run with it and just giving him the ball where he needs it, picking up nice first downs, going over the top of the defense for touchdowns, just having a tremendous day. Sophomore out of St. Pete, Florida.
Fifth best total in NC State history. Let's go to the studio now. Lo Galindo, what's up?
Well, guys, once you are done, we're going to get you out to Tallahassee, Florida to see the Duke Blue Devils take on the Florida State Seminoles. We got Dave Armstrong, Mike Gottfried, and Larry Coker standing by. Doug, should be a good one.
Hey, Lo, looking forward to it. And you and Tom Luganville in the studio tonight. And for FSU, boy, do they need a win.
Yeah.
NC State needs a win. FSU needs a win. In the worst sort of way, second down and 9. Virginia trying to keep their remarkable season going. And they wrap up Eugene. That's Jermaine Dias.
Well, Doug, the season won't be over, but you're right. They've just had such a hot streak in finding ways to win. If they can hold here on third down, get the ball back. It'll be interesting to see if they can finish the ball game like they have in the last few weeks.
That was a 2-yard loss for Eugene. Again, Bowen's a 202 yards receiving. Eugene, 112 yards rushing. And they're both sophomore. That's the future NC State football. Evans over the middle, looking for Bowens, and it goes incomplete, stops the clock with 1:34. I think I might have run the football there and run a little more time.
Yeah, you may want to question yourself on that. You thought it was a short throw where you could pick up, you know, a few yards and keep the clock moving, but any incomplete pass stops the clock. Good coverage there also.
This would be a 49-yard field goal if they wanted to attempt it. Or, excuse me, 51. So they'll go for the punt.
You're giving Virginia the ball back with some time. The cardiac kids.
Sticks Pearson on. Look at the splits on the line. One more team is doing that on punt formation. That takes a Virginia bounce. And they dive on it at the 17-yard line. Donald Bowens. Now look at the players in front of him. Torrey Holt, Jericho Cottry, Eddie Goines, and how Donald Bowens joins that elite group.
Well, you put your name up there in big bright lights. Torrey Holt, his name on the ring of honor here.
Let's see if Peter Lawlett, the freshman from Springfield, Virginia, bobbles the snap. Running for his life and running for the sidelines, and he, whoa, takes a shot out of bounds and stops the clock. Hops right back up. Willie Young again puts some pressure on the quarterback.
I told you. Sometimes you watch other players and you say, I'm tired of hearing about Chris Long. Let me leave my name on this game against East Carolina. Two sacks, three pressures this week. He's just playing like they expected him to. And Mike Archer said, we finally are smart enough to make the move to put him on the weak side and get him in a position where he can come off the edge.
Tom O'Brien in the pack, trying to taste victory in the ACC. First time in 9 tries. Lawlett complete. Brought down at the 20-yard line.
Seidenberg.
Mm-hmm. Jeremy Gray on the stop.
Flag on the play.
Right where the tackle was made. It's a face mask against the Wolfpack.
Come against Jeremy Gray.
Last ACC victory last year against Florida State, October 5th.
5-yard face mask. Defense. That's a 5-yard penalty. The distance did not result in the first down. We'll replay second down.
Right at the end there, you can see Jeremy Gray taking Seidenberg down and didn't get the personal foul face mask, just grabbing it, letting it go.
All right, Buck. They've lost 9 conference games in a row. Virginia has won 7 games this season in a row. They've never won 8 in a row in their history in a single season. Wallach to the outside, has his man, and he stays in bounds.
Kerry Koch doesn't do a very good job of getting out of bounds. Now they're going to have to spike the ball or call a timeout. Clock resets once the chains are established.
And the clock starts as Lawlett goes back. Needs to throw it away. Loose football. Virginia stays on it. Yeah. Ted Larson on the pressure. Big Brandon Albert got the loose football, and it's a timeout Virginia that used their last timeout.
Well, good coverage timeout in the secondary. Had
Virginia,
nowhere to go.
Lawlett's
looking
charge,
around.
Timeout.
Good play by Ted Larson. And, you know, that was a coverage sack right there, Doug.
Let's go back to the studio. Lo Galindo.
Yeah, guys, Duke and Florida State just underway in Tallahassee. We're going to get you out to that game as soon as you guys are done. Check out Florida State and the all-black unis. Rutgers did that earlier today. It did not work out. Doug, back to you.
Yeah, Lola, it didn't work out. In fact, they got hammered by West Virginia. And let's see if it's better luck for FSU. You know, the last 8 times they played Duke, Only once have they not scored at least 50 points, FSU. So something tells me, even though they struggle, they may do okay against the Blue Devils.
One of the days when you just had a home and away jersey. Now you can have multiple jerseys.
Of course, Coach Bowden is just one ahead of Coach Paterno now on the all-time wins list. And I thought it was interesting today on game day, Coach Paterno said, I don't care about that. I don't even know what the numbers are.
Yeah, right.
That's what Chris Fowler said. He says, seriously, maybe when I die, he said, I'll care about it. Wallet fires it too high. Bring up third down, Cavaliers.
It just looks like the offense is really, ever since Sewell went out, not been able to find that rhythm that they're accustomed to having. Third down and long. Need to come up with the first down, get out of bounds, stop the clock, and try to keep this drive going if you're Virginia. Wallace. NC State just has to make sure they don't make any mental errors and allow people to run free down the field.
There's Sewell on the bench. Two out of seven, Peter Lollett. Third down and 19. As his man could not connect with Maurice Covington. He was open, but it would have had this been a perfect pass.
Well, what we talked about, you know, the rhythm and the offense has just been out of sync. And Lollick with a nice throw, but just a little too far. And it almost looks like Covington, he knew where the sideline was and was trying to give Lollick a chance to slow him down some so he could stay in bounds. But if he had caught the ball, he would have been way out of bounds. Got to pull that fourth and 19 out of play out of your playbook, Doug.
They're one out of one today on fourth down, but I think Sewell actually scrambled for that first down. This will be Lollett's arm. Can he connect? He's going to run out of time, and he goes down in the arms of Willie Young, the sophomore who's been huge on the defensive side, and his counterpart, Donald Bowens, has been big on the offensive side.
He's made a name for himself against a strong and big Virginia offensive line, but the other key is the secondary. The changes in the secondary have really made a difference, and you can see Martrell Brown, Willie Young, all of the beneficiaries of a good, solid back four for North Carolina State.
Willie Young. The future looks awfully bright for that young man. Peter Lollick, a freshman, came in when Neil Sewell went to the sidelines. Time ticking away. Tom O'Brien and the NC State Wolfpack, their first win in the ACC since last October 5th. And the winning streak of the Cavaliers comes to an end.
Well, you can only live that way for so long, and finally you run across a team who has gotten hot late this season. So good job by North Carolina State.
NC State 29, Virginia 24. Coming up next, it's Duke against FSU. For more information, log on to your home for college sports, ESPNU.com. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Charles Arbuckle, Melissa Knowles, our entire ESPNU crew, I'm Doug Bell, saying so long from Raleigh. Time now to send you to Dope Campbell Stadium, Dave Armstrong, Mike Godfrey, and Larry Coker.